at you.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
It's Kevin and Querry.
I throw, you catch. It's not that hard, okay? All right, get the out of here.
I'm going to talk a lot about drills and fundamentals.
Watch it, watch it, watch it, watch it.
On 93.5.
Watch it.
And 107.5.
Boom, baby.
The Fan.
For a rainy, kind of dark Wednesday morning, Kevin, it's one of those days where you're like, man, there's a decent amount going on here, right? I mean, there's always kind of a Beatlemania feel whenever there's always an NBA team. I've always said from my childhood, first it was probably the Showtime Lakers or Bird's Celtics, then into the Jordan era of the Bulls, then into probably the next one would have been LeBron's Heat teams, and now obviously Golden State. Like when they're in town, there's a buzz kind of about it. Purdue's got a new football coach. You know, you've got Indiana taking on Kansas this weekend, which is big, and we start to gear up towards that a week out from Christmas. And
Purdue ranked number one?
Yeah, Purdue ranked number one, taking on Davidson. There's a ton going on.
Yeah, I would throw in Kobe's Lakers late in his career.
Yeah, that's
especially
fair.
When he went on that retirement tour. That was fair. Quite the scene that night inside of then Bankers Life Fieldhouse. But yeah, it is. You know, this is finals week for a ton of colleges, so you don't have college basketball really within the week. Like you said, IU and Kansas coming up on Saturday, Purdue and Davidson over at Gainbridge Fieldhouse. We'll actually have Davidson's head coach, Matt McKillop, join us a little bit later today. But I guess we will warn everyone on the drive in, and I'll put on my Karen Querry hat. This is wet leave morning, right?
That's right. Are there still leaves out?
I think there are still some stragglers out there. So it was raining on my commute in, and it sounded like, based off waking up at 3 a.m. with Max last night, it was raining last night. And walking to the car this morning looked like a good amount of rain we got. So just, you know, I know your mother would appreciate that. So
absolutely.
We need to make sure we're a little cautious on this commute in. Good Wednesday morning to you, Kevin Bowen, Jake Querry, and Mark Dykton. Jake, as much as you're willing to share, it sounded like you felt pretty confident in the old algebra final yesterday.
You know,
don't want to reveal too much, but
no, we're still awaiting official results for the semester. And I appreciate several people reached out to me to wish me luck on the final. Algebra has been my white whale my entire life. I have, as I've mentioned, and I've made a lot of light of it, but I, during the course of my first run through college, I dropped it 6 different times because I knew there was no way I was going to get the required 70%.
That sounds like a math problem in itself.
For sure. So I did have a tutor that worked with me diligently. And I think the thing that I found most fascinating, Kevin, was I still can't read the problems and understand what they're asking me. But she would articulate and she would read them to me and say, here's what they're asking you. Instead of me reading the problem like, well, I don't understand what this means. She would say, okay, what they're asking you is what number goes here that would make this happen. And then I could look at it and go, oh, okay. And on a lot of the problems yesterday, I would do it in my head. And she's like, well, wait a minute, you got to show your work. But at any rate, it's been an arduous journey to learn how my brain works in processing a lot of that stuff. And she was very patient with me. But I took the final. Initially, it listed it as like an 84 or something like that. And then when she went through and scoured through the way that I did everything, the final tally for my final was a 94 yesterday. Now, what that means in terms of me getting the required 70% to pass the class, there were 3 assignments a week for the last 16 weeks. That all has to be tallied up, and that shall be seen. But
that's awesome.
You know, it's like they said in Back to the Future, you put your mind to it, you can accomplish anything. Sometimes you need a little help.
Hey.
So, you know, but I was probably working about 8 to 10 hours a week on it by the time it was all said and done.
So, kudos to you for still being diligent
I'm
with that.
I'm not sure why I did it, but the white whale at least has been.
Hey, you could have thrown up the white flag, and
that's
you did
true.
Not do that. So
that's true.
That is a great accomplishment.
Thank
so
you.
Happy for you on that front. As you said, we've got a new head football coach in West Lafayette. His name is Ryan Walters. He's 36 years old. He is the fourth youngest head coach in college football right now at the age of 36. And I guess he already won yesterday by doing the old viral hand out the scholarship video. Devin Mockaby, well-deserved Purdue running back, getting that scholarship. So that made the rounds on social media yesterday.
What was the most common reaction from people when they saw that? But weren't most people like, wait a minute, he wasn't on scholarship?
Well, that's what Walters said to him. Walters was like, yeah, the first thing I thought when we played you last year, because I think Mockaby had over 100 yards against Illinois, was like, wait.
Which was a darn good defense.
Oh, incredible defense. What the hell's going on over there in West Lafayette that you're not on scholarship? So, yes, he has put Devin Mockaby on scholarship. You look at the defensive resume of Walters, Jake, and it is eye-popping. I mean, it is beyond impressive what he did at Illinois in just two seasons. They were ranked, I think when he took over, he was at Missouri as defensive coordinator, left there and joined Brett Bielema's staff at Illinois. They were 97th in scoring and 114th in total yards allowed. Both of those are obviously horrific numbers. They jumped in one season. They jumped from 97th of scoring to 29th. They jumped from 114 in yards allowed to 49. And then in his second year, this past season, those numbers jumped to first in college football in scoring defense and second in total yards allowed. So that's the first thing I think that you notice with his resume. It's that defensively, it's a total shift from how Purdue is typically operated at the head coaching position. The question that I have, and it's a question, you know, I think for just modern football in general, and honestly, I think it's a question that the guy in Bloomington is still trying to answer. If you get a revolving door going offensively, Jake, it can be very difficult to sustain success. And that is my biggest question mark with Ryan Walters. What do you do offensively? And when you have some success offensively, how do you maintain that? Because the trend is colleges want to nab that young offensive coordinator. Look at IU with Tom Allen. Kellen DeBoer a few years ago, great success as an offensive coordinator with Tom Allen as a head coach. He moves to Fresno State. He's now at Washington with Michael Penix. They're having great success. And Indiana's offense has not sniffed what it was a few years ago because they've had, I want to say it's four offensive coordinators in 6 years. So maybe it's a little low-hanging fruit by me, Jake, to immediately go to Indiana with that. But that is just the one concern I have is offensively, how can you sustain it when your head coach is more of the defensive side of the ball?
Was he a candidate for Colorado's job? And I realize, I mean, I get why they hired Deion Sanders, but was his name mentioned at all for Colorado?
And you bring that up because he played at Colorado.
Correct. And that's where he began his coaching career.
So Scott Ritchie's going to join us coming up in the 9 o'clock hour, who covers Fighting Illini Athletics. And that's a question I want to ask him. If I'm not mistaken, I believe his name was thrown around. I don't know if he – I think I saw one report yesterday where he maybe pulled his name out of that, which would be interesting. Considering it's his alma mater, and this is really the first time he's been a serious head coaching candidate. But that is something that I'm curious about. His name, I do feel like, was kind of a hot name. I don't know if he was, you know, one or two on Mike Pavinsky's list to pursue. I would say one thing I do like about him is when you hear his defensive style, you hear, like, uber aggressive and tons of variety. So if that's your philosophical approach, you would tend to think as a head coach, you would want that to kind of be staples of what you want your offense to be. And I think that is an encouraging element. Again, he doesn't obviously have the offensive background, but I like that better than, and I remember saying this to Mark when the Bears hired Matt Eberflus. My concern with that was, again, if Justin Fields has success, that offense coordinator might not be there for long stretches. And Eberflus just isn't some aggressive-minded defensive head coach. It's, we do what we do, and we do it better than anybody else. I don't love that approach. I like the Walters approach where it's, we'll be very multiple, we'll be very versatile. Week to week, you don't know what we're going to throw at you.
If I was to critique the Purdue hire, and again, there are a lot of positives to it. If I were to point out any areas where I'm hesitant, it would be the following. I like that they went with kind of a young, up-and-coming, eager, hungry guy.
Do you worry that's a stepping stone, though?
I'm not as worried about that as I am the following, and that is that I think that Jeff Brohm left Purdue in a really good situation. And so for that reason, I feel like I would have, if it were up to me, and I like Mike Bobinski a great deal, actually, and I got a lot of respect for him, and I think he's been really good. But if it were up to me, which is why I'm on the radio, not an athletic director perhaps, I would have probably preferred a coach that there was going to be no like CEO leadership learning on the job, because the pieces are in place. I would have rather a guy, like I would have rather just been able to seamlessly hand the wheel over to somebody while we're doing 50 miles an hour than somebody who's got that's still learning how to drive a stick. Like, there are areas of being a head coach that in terms of delegation and navigation of things that anybody has to learn, and I would have preferred somebody that doesn't have to learn those things on the job.
Yeah, it's funny you say that, Jake. I felt like I heard a side of Purdue fans going there, and then I heard the side of Purdue fans that are like, I don't want a retread head coach that might not be as open-minded with NIL as you need to be. Whereas the 36-year-old first-time head coach might be more open-minded to it.
And that's probably a valid point because that's where we are, right?
And you can kind of go glass half full on either side of that. I do think one thing that you got to like if you're a Purdue fan is, you know, Illinois is a very similar recruiting landscape to what Purdue is, in the sense of, it's not like he came in there and had five stars all over his defense and just needed to coach him up a little bit. He had to develop. They've had a heavy footprint, it looks like, in the state of Florida from a recruiting standpoint. And talking to some people yesterday, sounds like a pretty mild-mannered guy. You're not like super rah-rah. And I honestly think you saw that in the Maccabee video when he handed out that scholarship yesterday. You know, one thing I kind of forgot about this Purdue team, at times last year, they were so undisciplined, particularly late in games with penalties. So I think that is something that, you know, Walters needs to instill. It's a 5-year contract for him. Introductory presser at noon today. Mark, any word on if we'll get him on this week?
Mid-cereal.
Should have looked up and saw your chipmunk cheeks. Out.
We'll see if the bat signal answers.
Mid-chew. What's for breakfast this morning, Mark? You haven't done cereal this in bar. A while.
You look like he had some Honey Grahams in the left cheek.
Honey Grahams?
Are you lactose intolerant? What happened? No. You used to bring bowls of cereal in here.
I used to inject milk into me like by IV. I drink milk all the time.
Well, you haven't done so in a while.
I'm a big milk guy.
It's a lot of stuff to bring. It's a lot of things. It's a process.
Is that the cereal bar that I generously gave you like 2 weeks ago that you never ate?
No. Because I have 900 of those same exact Nutri-Grain bars.
You did the same thing.
Because I went to Costco as well. And I'm like, that's a hell of a deal. And then they've just been sitting there.
I have enough cereal bars to feed like, half of Brazil. That's correct. So here you go. Come by the house, take cereal bars with you.
It's like, pass that out to the Argentina folks yesterday.
It's like zucchini to me. How about Messi yesterday?
After their 3-0 win. Trade nil? Win and... the World Cup semifinal over Croatia.
I believe Nil Trey.
Oh, Nil Trey. That's how we go with it. Sure. A couple goals for Messi. Today it'll be France and Morocco. This is like favorite versus George Mason VCU in the Final Four. That's what today is with France and Morocco, the other semifinal.
What's the native language of Morocco? Don't they speak French there?
That's
a great
question.
It's an African nation, but it's a Northern African nation.
On the Mediterranean, correct?
Yes, but I believe, I don't know why I'm thinking that it is a nation of French influence. I could be completely wrong in that. Arabic, apparently, is predominant. Here we go. 33% French. I knew there was some, but predominantly Arabic.
For all of our Pacers folk out there, it's probably a little bit more of, are you a parent of a Steph Curry fan tonight inside of Gainbridge Fieldhouse? Jake, I tried to throw some caution yesterday of pay attention to this game tonight. Warriors-Bucks.
What you want is a blowout. What'd you get last night? You got the Warriors getting blown out. Steph Curry not 1 minute in the fourth quarter. Don't believe Draymond Green played in the fourth quarter. 27 minutes for Curry. 23 for Draymond. Is that good news about them playing tonight on the back-to-back?
I think they'll play, don't you? Load management.
So I've looked at those three. Basically, this is how they've operated, the big three this year. Klay Thompson has sat out all the back-to-backs coming off the ACL. So if you follow that pattern, Klay Thompson, I would consider him pretty iffy for tonight. He played 27 minutes last night. Draymond has sat out about half of them, and Steph has gone kind of every other. He's due to sit out this one. But again, if you look at last night's result, I guess it depends how Steve Kerr approached these two games. Did he tell these guys on Monday, hey, no matter what, you're going to play Tuesday but not Wednesday? Or did he say, let's see how Tuesday night goes,
right,
and then we'll figure out Wednesday? Because again, they got, I mean, they didn't play great last night. They barely played in the fourth quarter. I think Klay was the only one of the big three. So I am probably a little bit more encouraged that Steph Curry might play tonight than I would have been this time tomorrow or yesterday.
There are a lot of, did you say it, Kevin? I believe the way you said it was a lot of the caramel pups.
This is caramel pups night inside of Gainbridge Fieldhouse. They should just put 10 pups in the Indy car to rev it up for tonight. Carmel Pups, 8-1 this year, you know, and they beat Center Grove's Trojans B team, and yeah, that's the Carmel Pups rev up night. You have the pup jacket, you take it off.
I wonder
and you got
when
the
we'll
Steph
know.
Curry
usually it's
jersey.
Probably around what 5:30, 6 o'clock when you get the kind of the word officially of whether or not guys play.
Because typically teams don't do shoot arounds off of back to back, so I don't think you'll get the morning shoot around for Golden State. We probably could just go over to the local hotel here that they're staying at and try to see if Steve Kerr's in the lobby getting some coffee this morning.
You want me to go over there? Mark, you want to head over? Get yourself another cereal bar?
Yeah. Really good boots on the ground from a reporting standpoint.
When I was a kid, back in the day.
A lot of autograph seekers out there.
There was nothing more fun. The two things when I was a kid, and this is why there is a certain magic to when a Steph Curry or LeBron, Giannis maybe, is in the building. And that is, it does take me back to when I was a kid. And the old third floor east side ramp of Market Square Arena where the bus would be. And you'd wait out there by the bus for when the teams would come out of the locker room. And they walked right out, right onto the bus, onto the loading ramp. And if you sat there off in the wing, sometimes a player would see you and throw shoes or come over and sign autographs. And if that didn't work, if they stayed overnight, you would, and back then most teams did because they flew commercial, you'd go to the Hyatt. In the downtown Hyatt with the glass elevators, and man, there was nothing better than like sitting there and looking on the glass elevator, and you're like, oh my gosh, there's Gerald Wilkins. And, I mean, I would sit there. I was that kid. I still have a right Nike shoe that was signed by Gerald Wilkins because my buddy got the left. We split it. He was like, here, you guys can split my shoes. And he signed them both.
I love that.
That was great. It was a lot of fun.
This from Wheezy. Pacers are a 1.5-point underdog. That indicates Vegas saying Steph and Klay will not play.
Say that again?
Pacers are just a 1.5-point underdog. He believes that indicates that Steph and Klay will not play.
Boy, there'd be a lot of disappointed caramel pups.
A lot of disappointed pups in the building tonight. And, you know, this is the night where if you're working Pacers security or you're, you know, part of the team that kind of opens up the field house, I mean, you get a wave of people coming in there right when the gates open because everyone wants to watch Steph warm up.
I mean, it is kind of cool, right, when he starts.
Oh, it's unbelievable to watch. So Pacers-Warriors tonight at 7. If we see anything on that front, we'll certainly keep you posted. Chris Duarte's got a 2-game stint with the Mad Ants coming up this week. I believe the first game is tonight, so Duarte a little bit closer to playing. If you missed it, Rick Carlisle was on our show late yesterday. We'll play some of that audio here in a little bit from Carlisle. I did like a line he mentioned yesterday about, you know, we need to add talent as we move along. I think the record and the performance lately, Jake, has created a little bit of this, but it's important, I think, to remember that you got off to a great start. But at the end of the day, this is still a big picture approach to the season. You can't fall into the trap of, hey, could we sneak into the play-in game? No, you need to realize that when the trade deadline comes around, you look at anything and everything for both Miles Turner and Buddy Hield, particularly with Turner, considering the contract situation, and you realize that you're still multiple pieces away from being a true contender in the Eastern Conference.
Yeah, I think...
it's been a fun start, but there's still a lot of questions.
That's a fair way of saying it. Your magic number necessary is what?
30, and I'm starting to get a little nervous.
Are you really?
Saturday was a disappointing one for me.
Okay.
The Nets missing their top eight, and you can't win that one?
The Pacers are 14-14, right?
Correct.
Okay. So that's 28 games. They play 82 total, right? So that's 54 remaining games, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So the 54 remaining games, you need them to win 16 of them?
Right.
Come on. You need them to go 16-20. All they've got to do is go 16-28 down the stretch? No, 16-38.
And my thinking, Jake, was they would make some moves at the deadline, so they would be a far worse team post-deadline than they are early in the year. So I need a buffer. And the schedule's daunting coming up. I need rest tonight. I'm sorry. Caramel Pups, I apologize to the Pups out there. I need Steph on the bench.
Can you see the concern?
Yeah.
I'm starting to sweat a little.
I can tell.
Is it because of the money that you would lose or because of the money you would lose out on?
Out on. I mean, it literally comes down to...
like, you haven't told the wife yet what you Max have in the balance?
Is Max going to be Ivy League or is he going to be online?
Okay.
I appreciate you guys just cackling, thinking this is a funny manner.
The idea that he would go to, like, University of Phoenix over Yale is kind of...
That's been on the table. That's a debate. No, I got a little excited earlier in the year and I told Maddie. Probably a mistake. Should have waited till... you know,
put
20
a little heat
wins,
on you, did she?
21 wins. How about Golden State being 14-14? The battle of 14-14 teams tonight.
Doesn't it seem like Golden State, though, is one of those teams, not unlike a lot of the LeBron teams earlier in his career, I'm not speaking necessarily for now, but where you kind of feel like, it, even if this isn't the case, that they have the ability to flip the switch? Like, okay, they go, you know?
But still, I mean, that's a surprising start for them. So
there's a lot of surprising starts in the NBA. I mean, you know, the Pelicans. Did anybody think the Pelicans would be right up towards the top of the West?
Miami probably falls in the boat of...
I thought Detroit would be better than they are.
So Cade Cunningham's done for the year?
Yes.
Boy, that's brutal.
Surgery, right?
I see shin. Is that good for Jaden Ivey or no?
I think it's probably good, right? Because it's baptism by fire. Like, you got to go.
Yeah.
We're going to put you in, you got to go.
Brian goes, I have a rule for my son. We go to those types of games where somebody like Steph Curry's playing. He's not allowed to wear any apparel of the opposing team. I kind of like that.
Okay.
I might implement that as a parent one day. See how successful I am. But
if you had no say, I have always felt, Kevin, I've always felt with sports that for the most part, people as an adult, their favorite teams usually are based on any of the four following things. The first and foremost, of course, being where they were raised, if there's a home team. But if your favorite team is not the hometown team, I think more often than not, it's one of three things. It's either the first team you played for in Little League, regardless of the sport, the team when you were first introduced to the sport whose color scheme you liked when you were a kid, so you rooted for them, or the team that your dad or person of influence rooted for when you were a kid. Sometimes, actually, the rival of the team that your dad or someone of influence rooted for, because that made it fun to be able to root against that team.
Yeah, I think that's right.
But, like, my dad really liked Larry Bird when I was growing up, and so I wouldn't say I was a Lakers fan, but I rooted for the Lakers over the Celtics just to kind of make it fun of the good-natured ribbing back and forth. Obviously, I was an IU fan because my dad was an IU fan. I grew up in Indiana. And what I knew when I was a kid was when I saw people wearing the shirt that said Indiana, and I'm like, well, I live there. That's where I'm from. So, you know, so I was an Indiana fan, right? But, and as I mentioned, football-wise, the two teams that were on television the most regularly when I began watching the NFL were the Cowboys and the Steelers, and I liked the color scheme of the Steelers, and my dad worked in the steel business, so that's what I picked, and there you go. So there are, so in terms of your son not wearing the colors of the team when they go to the game itself, I don't know, man. If he's a fan of the team, let him do it. That's the way I look at it. But
that's a soft mindset by you. We need to create local market fans. Getting choked up thinking about it.
Fair enough.
Yeah, on the color scheme front, my nephew, he's big into the logos. Uncle Bowen, what's your favorite NFL logo? That's his big thing.
And didn't you tell me that he had picked the, was it the Bucks?
I think he was a big Chiefs fan as well.
Okay.
Yeah, he slots the helmets each week, does the matchups. He gets very into it.
Well, the Seahawks logo is the best one.
He does like the Seahawks logo.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
But he has some, you know, he lined them up after week one, who was 1-0 and who was 0-1, and go over to his house, and he's got the Colts and Texans on top of each other for their nice tie. I'm like, this sums up the Colts season right
now,
here.
Now, what about
this is awkward.
Very.
What about the Browns? What does he think of the Browns? Is he very confused by that?
Yeah, I don't think he's a huge fan. You know,
the little elf?
Kind of a poopy color scheme there, isn't it?
What have you? They're orange. Have you checked what's going on with his diet?
I mean, yes. a physician.
Have you checked the flu season, Jake? I mean, right now you never know what's happening.
What are they feeding the kid over there?
Just
that's
wait till you
here.
Yeah, just wait till you get what Mark and I had been dealing with. On the Colts front, we'll get to this a little bit later. Matt Ryan playing in 2023. He had some comments on that. A little bit of a different tone, I would say. And Matt Ryan's comments back in March on that front. And we're almost forgetting, like, does Jeff Saturday want to coach? It's a question threw at him yesterday. We'll give you that answer as well. And the Colts lose another member of their offensive coaching staff. They're now down three coaches on that side of the ball. We'll explain more coming up a little bit later. Again, a rainy start to this Wednesday here in Indianapolis. Kevin Bowen, Jake Query, Mark Dykton.
Well, this is different. It's Saturday. On Saturday, the Colts play the Vikings in Minnesota Saturday. Matt Taylor has the kickoff at 1 o'clock on your home for the Colts, 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan. Indy's number one for new country. I got some famous friends. Nobody plays more new country. 97.1 Hank FM.
Come to Auto Sales and Service and drive home in a vehicle with no credit required. They've been helping people find a new ride in Indy for 35 years. Stop by their two Indianapolis locations. Auto Sales and Service.
Saturday, the Butler Bulldogs open Big East play hosting the undefeated and top 5 ranked UConn Huskies. Tip-off is 7 p.m. Visit butlersports.com/buy tickets. Get to Hinkle Fieldhouse this weekend.
Sometimes an injury or death happens due to someone else's mistake. Find justice with the injury attorneys at Parr Ritchie at 317-269-2509. PARRinjury.com.
Hey Colts fans, it's Mark from Kevin and Query, and now is the perfect time to download FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook, because right now new customers get a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. That's free bets back if your first bet doesn't win. All you have to do is download the FanDuel Sportsbook app and sign up with promo code Mark. FanDuel is all your favorite bets, from the money line to point spreads to player props. You can combine your bets for a chance at a bigger payout with the same game parlay. They have live betting, so you'll get updated odds on games that have already started. Plus, when you win, get paid fast, all on an app that's safe, secure, and super easy to use. So what are you waiting for? Download the FanDuel Sportsbook app today and sign up with promo code Mark for your no-sweat first bet. Again, that's promo code Mark, M-A-R-C, and make every moment more this season with FanDuel, official sportsbook partner of the Indianapolis Colts. 21 and over and present in Indiana. First online real money wager only. Refund issued is now withdrawable free bets that expire in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Are you still looking for the perfect holiday gift? You know what I'm talking about. The one that gets passed around the room and you hear a lot of oohs and ahs? Then come to Shane Company. We put so much love and care into the fine jewelry we create. Our classic styles are true treasures. With our expertise and attention to detail, they can be handed down to the next generation and look as beautiful as the day you bought them. They're a great investment. We have diamond tennis bracelets, classic solitaire pendants, and styles with cultured pearls. Our diamond stud earrings make a wonderful holiday gift because they'll never lose that amazing sparkle. We have a wide range of shapes and carat weights to choose from, so it'll be easy to find studs in your price range. We also offer studs in a variety of colorful gemstones. And with Shane Company's generous upgrade policy, you can upgrade your studs at any time. Visit us in-store or shop online and enjoy free two-day shipping. It's never too late to give a gift they'll treasure forever.
Now you have a friend in the jewelry business. Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
This holiday season, DraftKings Sportsbook app is giving Indiana Pacers fans a special gift. Everyone can get a no-sweat bet on every Pacers game this December. Head to the DraftKings Sportsbook app, opt in under the promos tab, and place an eligible bet of your choice on a Pacers game. If it doesn't hit, you'll get your money back in a free bet. With payouts bigger than ever, DraftKings Sportsbook app is the place to go to bet on the NBA. Download the DraftKings Sportsbook app now. New customers can sign up with a promo code 1075FAN and get a no-sweat bet on every Pacers game this December. Go to the DraftKings Sportsbook app and opt in today to receive this limited-time offer only at DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sports betting partner of the Indiana Pacers. Must be 21 or older, Indiana only. Max reward limits apply. One free bet issued based on amount of initial losing bet. Eligibility restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.draftkings.com/basketball terms. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Family or friends in town for the holidays? Show them a good time, great scratch food, and even better scenic views at Twin Peaks. With plenty of shareable things on the menu, this is your place for holiday gatherings. Contact your favorite location for more info today. And as always, Twin Peaks is honoring the pursuit of brews and barrel-aged bourbon every Friday at their Bourbon and Brews Party. Get to Twin Peaks from 5 to 7 p.m. to experience a lingerie costume party paired with exceptional bourbons, tastings, and giveaways.
Twin Peaks. Eats, drinks, scenic views.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly.
See the road ahead more clearly with Sylvania Bulbs and O'Reilly Auto Parts. Right now, purchase select Sylvania Bulbs and get up to a $20 gift card after mail-in rebate, plus 2x O'Rewards points. Replace your bulbs today and see better tonight. Let the professional parts people help you find the bulbs you need. Visit O'Reilly Auto Parts or O'ReillyAuto.com.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Meet Joe A.
Hi.
Joe B.
Hello.
And Joe C.
What's up?
Three everyday Joes perfecting their banking with Chase. Joe A is locking his lost debit card with the Chase mobile app. Joe B is cruising toward his new ride with AutoSave. And Joe C's Chase banker is helping him budget to go back to school. Tools that help protect, support for what's next. One bank that puts you in control. Visit chase.com/checking. Chase, make more of what's yours.
Chase mobile app is available for select mobile devices. Messaging and data rates may apply. JP Morgan Chase Bank, NA member FDIC.
Ladies and gentlemen, please. 40, love, match point.
Out.
There's no way that was out.
Out. The ball is out. It's out.
Are you even watching?
No, honestly, I'm not. I'm watching college football on my phone with AT&T 5G.
Wow, that's too much.
With AT&T 5G, too much college football is never too much. 5G requires compatible plan and device. 5G may not be available in your area. See att.com/5G for you for details.
Hubler has all the top brands. Chevy, Buick, GMC, Ford, Acura, Honda, Mazda, Nissan, and more. And every new vehicle includes a 10-year, 200,000-mile warranty. Looking to sell your vehicle? We'll pay you top dollar, even if you don't buy ours. Take it from Brooke Hubler.
You can get a car anywhere, but you can only get a warranty like this at Hubler. 10 years, 200,000 miles.
Visit drivehubler.com.
Hubler has it all.
Warranty available on new vehicles except certain models not transferable or available on leases. A copy of the warranty is available for review at the dealership.
The Morning Checkdown, brought to you by Ball State Basketball. Get your tickets at ballstatesports.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Jake, tonight over in Gainbridge Fieldhouse, it's Pacers and Warriors. They'll wrap up a four-game homestand here. Both teams, 14-14 on the year. Again, we are on Warriors watch in terms of who will they play coming off the back-to-back. They got smoked last night in Milwaukee, so their big three really didn't play much, if at all, in the fourth quarter. That'd be Steph Curry, 27 total minutes, Klay Thompson, 27, Draymond Green, 23. If I had to rank it, Jake, I'd probably rank it in the order of least likely to most likely to play would probably be Klay Thompson, Steph Curry, Draymond Green.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. Giannis, by the way, 30-12 last night for the Bucks, 128-111 over the Warriors. Other winners in the association, it was Philly over Sacramento, 123-103. Joel Embiid with 31. It was Houston over Phoenix, 111-97. Utah upsetting the New Orleans Pelicans, and Boston, 122-118. Jason Tatum with 44 for the Celtics.
Again, we had Rick Carlisle on the show late yesterday. Here was the Pacers head coach on the matchup with Golden State.
Well, they're as difficult as any team you're going to face, you know, really simply because of their shooting ability, the fact that they pass and move so well. And Steve has really developed a random style of playing that has a level of unpredictability, even though you know that, you know, Steph and Klay and, you know, now Poole and Wiggins are going to touch it a lot. You know, they have a style that doesn't involve a lot of play calling. So you have to really prepare conceptually for these guys.
I like conceptually as a word to be used for anything. It just sounds really intelligent. You know what I mean?
Wiggins has been a little banged up.
Wiggins is out, I believe.
Correct? He's out.
Yeah. Well, he's been listed. He's been on, yep. I don't know if he's on IR, but he's had, I don't know if it's a calf issue.
Poole played 32 minutes last night. He was their biggest minutes.
Been a good player, too.
Yeah. Very, very good for them. Yesterday, World Cup, you saw Argentina move into the final. They beat Croatia. Nil tray is what Jake wants to go with. It just sounds awful. Sure. Lionel Messi, outstanding in that one, and they will now face the winner of France and Morocco today. That's a 2 o'clock kick from the pitch.
I'd like to see Morocco win that game.
First African nation as a semifinalist.
Yeah. So if I'm not mistaken, and I'm not a genius, but I think that means they would be the first African nation in the finals.
Well, yeah.
Good to see that.
See. Great.
You got the 2 + 2 = 4 on your algebra final yesterday.
My favorite part of that was, I'm not a genius, as if that was ever called into question.
It was good to clarify that from the start.
I got news for you. This IQ here, I mean, we're talking, what, 160, 170, somewhere in there?
Yeah.
Don't you like the fact I think the maximum somebody can get is like a 145. Yeah, that guy's got an IQ of 180, really?
Okay. It's good to see the humility meters right up there with the IQ meter.
An IQ on the back of a Raisin Brand box. Yeah, I got a 190. Okay.
Purdue's got a new head football coach. His name is Ryan Walters, 36 years old, the fourth youngest head coach in FBS currently. Introduced today at noon. It is a 5-year contract for him. Jake, anything stand out to you in particular on the old Walters resume?
You know, the one thing that does jump out at me is the fact that he has coached along the way at some pretty big-time programs. I mean, he's been, even if it's peripherally, you know, not just Illinois, but Missouri, Oklahoma, Arizona, played at Colorado, so he's been around some big-time schools. He was, you knew who his babysitter was when he was little?
I see Eric Bieniemy.
That is correct. Eric Bieniemy, but young guy. I mean, admittedly, like when he got off the plane, I'm like, wow. I mean, they went young for certain. I personally would have liked to have seen them go with a guy who was coming off of a level of being a head coach, but I do kind of trust Mike Babinski. I think he's been really good as an AD, and I'm very curious to see what happens.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of reasons to be intrigued if you're a Purdue fan. Again, the curious one for me is just how can you maintain offensive success? And it's a good problem to have if your offense shows a level early on in Walter's tenure to where, you know, they want to pursue a new, or that offensive coach, you know, is being courted by some teams to be a head coach elsewhere. But that's been a struggle in Bloomington for Tom Allen. That's something that Ryan Walters will have to secure, considering that has been Purdue's calling card. Even when the wins maybe hasn't been at the level that you would like, they've been an entertaining product. I think that's important for your fan base. One NFL note from yesterday, Kyler Murray confirmed torn ACL. I think that impacts the Colts. And what does Arizona do this offseason on the quarterback front? Do you now throw them into the mix as a team needing a quarterback, considering right now they are one spot ahead of the Colts in the draft order? Speaking of the Colts, Matt Ryan playing in 2023. Jeff Saturday, does he want to coach next year? We'll hear from both of them on that coming up next year. Kevin McQuarrie.
The Pacers homestand concludes with the Golden State Warriors this evening at 6:30 on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Hi guys, it's Mark. Are you struggling with erectile dysfunction? Did you know that a major medical breakthrough is now available and it isn't a pill? Today, Wednesday, December 14th, we're running a one-day special you won't want to miss out on. Pine Grove Medical Clinic uses the most powerful form of wave therapy. This is a technology clinically shown to repair blood vessels and improve blood flow. It's backed by 60 clinical studies, including from Cambridge. If you're ready to regain the spark in your bedroom, today is your day. Call us now and you'll qualify for the assessment and ultrasound totally free. You'll also get a gift that can produce rapid and powerful results in the bedroom in minutes. You're going to love that one, guys. Trust me. And today only, we're offering 6 tune-up treatments to our patients free. This is an unprecedented offer worth hundreds of dollars, but call today and qualify totally free. Call 317-552-1111. That's 317-552-1111. Guys, put a stop to your erectile dysfunction and get your life back. Call Pine Grove Medical Clinic now to qualify. This offer ends today, Wednesday. 317-552-1111.
You wouldn't leave your health to chance. Doesn't your financial well-being deserve the same care and attention? It's time to get a complimentary wealth checkup from Edelman Financial Engines. We're Barron's number one rated independent financial advisory firm 5 years running. So you can be confident you're getting integrated wealth management advice, including tax planning, estate planning, insurance, and more from an experienced and trusted investment advisory firm. Take advantage of a complimentary wealth checkup with a planner who puts your needs first. There's no sales pressure and no obligation, just trusted guidance to help get your investment goals back into focus. When it comes to your financial well-being, you can count on the top-rated independent financial advisory firm in the nation. Visit Edelman Financial Engines at efewealthplanners.com. That's efewealthplanners.com. Barron's rating awarded annually each September 2018 through 2022. Compensation paid for distribution of rating.
Bowling, 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 keep them balls a-rolling. Bowling, 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 Royal Pin.
Make your plans now for a fun holiday party at any Royal Pin Entertainment Center. Treat your employees to a great time with bowling, appetizers from chips to heavy hors d'oeuvres, food packages from pizza to prime rib, and a wide range of party options from just bowling to laser tag, limitless VR, go-karts, arcade, and more. You can upgrade with adult beverages, craft beer, premium spirits, and frozen drinks. Want a custom party? Their sales team can make it happen. Reward your team for their hard work. Email events at royalpin.com or visit royalpin.com to book today.
Set them up, knock them down, send them flying, spinning round.
Hurry, space is filling up fast. That's royalpin.com.
Royal Pin, bowling, bowling. Royal Pin, bowling.
Have you been waiting for the perfect time to propose or show them how much their love means to you? The first of a lifetime of holidays surrounded by those you love is just the moment you've been looking for. And at Diamonds Direct, we're here to make that magic happen. Diamonds Direct's got the unbeatable prices you're used to, plus 0% interest financing for 3 years. You can get the most amazing romantic gift and spread your payments over 3 years with zero interest. That means an $8,000 diamond pendant or tennis bracelet is just over $220 a month. At Diamonds Direct, we have the best gifts. Rings, bands, earrings, all new one-of-a-kind designer jewelry, starting as low as $500. So relax and enjoy the holidays. Get that incredible gift at a price you didn't think was possible and take advantage of 3 years zero interest financing. Come in today or go online for store hours and directions and check out our all-new holiday gift guide to make it super easy. Happy holidays from Diamonds Direct. Your love, our passion.
What if this holiday season you could give your loved ones the gift of never, ever having to bend down or touch their shoes to put them on? Like ever again? That's a pretty powerful gift. And that gift would be new hands-free Skechers slip-ins. That's right. With new Skechers slip-ins, your loved ones can just step in and go to put their shoes on. And no, this isn't holiday magic. This is the latest breakthrough from Skechers, the comfort technology company. So how do new Skechers slip-ins work? There's a special comfort pillow in the heel that helps your foot slide into place and keeps it secure in cozy comfort, which means slip-ins go on easy and stay on. Plus, they come in all your favorite fashionable styles for the whole family, including kids. Imagine how easy it will be for kids to get these on. That's a gift from mom and dad, too. And slip-ins are affordable, which means you can give them to everybody on your list and even slip in a pair for yourself. Find slip-ins at a Skechers store, Skechers.com, or wherever stylish footwear is sold.
You're the one who protects the flock, and that requires an eye for detail. Because when safety and well-being are on the line, it's the details that can save lives. Even when no one else is watching, you see everything. Grainger gets you, and we're here for you, and all the ones who get it done with a wide range of safety products and solutions, plus board-certified safety consultants here to answer your questions. Call, click Grainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Progressive is America's number one motorcycle insurer, so we understand motorcycles. No, really, we have a bike translator.
Okay, so this bike says she is struggling with her place in the motorcycle community. Well, she says she hasn't peaked yet, but she's having a little epiphany, okay. Oh, that maybe life itself is the peak. Interesting. In my experience, I found that... Oh, so I just translate. Not allowed to have opinions. Got it.
Quote with Progressive and see if you could save with America's number one motorcycle insurer. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates.
Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan. It's a
maniac. Jake, in my history covering the Colts, I don't recall this happening very often, if at all. But yesterday, Jeff Saturday confirmed that a member of their coaching staff, Clayton Adams, coached the tight end group, has left the organization to go take the offensive line coaching position for the Stanford Cardinal. Adams has some ties to the Bay Area. I think Sacramento is where he's from. So, you know, makes sense from a family standpoint. But I think bigger picture, it's just a reminder of how everyone on that coaching staff probably feels right now.
Got to go for the sure thing.
There's no guarantee I'm here next year.
Yep.
And if it's a college job, if it's a different type of pay, that doesn't matter. I've got to go somewhere where I know I'm guaranteed to get a spot. And that's what Clayton Adams did yesterday in going to Stanford. So no Frank Reich, no Marcus Brady, no Clayton Adams. Jeff said yesterday that Kevin Mawai, the assistant O-line coach, will now help with more of the blocking side of the tight end group. Reggie Wayne, obviously the wideout coach, will be a little bit more with the receiving part of the tight end position. But again, it's just another reminder of there is so much uncertainty to what's going to happen on January 9th, that first Monday after your final game with Houston, on what happens. And if you're a coach, even if Jeff Saturday is retained, there's no guarantee any of these assistants will be around. You got to think Jeff Saturday has a list of guys that he wants.
Does it feel to you at all like, I'm not saying it is, but I'm saying, does it feel this way? Does it feel at all, somewhat inevitably and understandably, but just like it's kind of dysfunctional and there's just a lot of people like,
yeah,
kind of every man for themselves type deal?
Yeah, I think that's fair. And Jake, I'd probably say the same thing for any organization that is facing questions at, again, those pillar positions within your franchise, but even more so when you've made such an interesting interim move. And I don't know, does the coaching staff in Carolina feel the same uncertainty, or the fact that Steve Wilks and the Panthers have seemingly steadied the ship big time and could make the playoffs, does that interim staff feel a little bit different than the Colts staff? I would think they do. And I guess that's kind of the root of the Saturday question of, you know, Jim Irsay was very adamant, Jake, that the Colts were not tanking upon hiring Jeff Saturday. I believe he said something to the effect of, we're in this thing. 9-7-1 gets us in the dance. So given the fact that he said that publicly, don't we have to evaluate Saturday at some level on wins and losses?
Yeah. I mean, yes, this was not...
Jeff Saturday is going to win you over in every team meeting, in every press conference. At some point, albeit he was thrown into a difficult situation, I totally acknowledge that, don't we have to evaluate him on that win-loss record?
Do you feel like they have played better under him? Do they seem more focused? Do they seem sharper? Do they seem...
Definitely have gotten off the better starts. There's no debating that. They've gotten off the better starts. I think the O-line play has improved slightly. Outside of that, it's pretty same old to me. They still struggle late in games. They can't score. And they're 1-3 with them.
Do you believe that regardless, legitimate question, so I'm not trying to lead your answer here. Legitimate question. Do you, Kevin Bowen, believe that regardless of outcome this year, that Jeff Saturday's potential to be the head coach of the Indianapolis Colts next year would be unaffected? In other words, do you believe that he is just as viable a candidate to be hired by Jim Irsay for next season if they lose out versus if they win out?
Yeah, that's a debate that I have. I mean, win out, yeah. I mean, Irsay would hire him on the spot. He'd right. probably she'd probably try and carry him off the field at Lucas Oil Stadium, which would be a sight to see. Maybe he could do, you know, golf cart ride out and then do the video in the little entry pavilion. Maybe get a jet engine in there, some sort of sound.
The dog, would the dog be there?
Yeah, Drake would be there, yeah. Certainly. Drake the dog. You know, question I threw, yes, to your point, I do think record matters. You know, I asked Saturday yesterday, is this something you want to do next year? Which I felt kind of stupid asking that question because, again, like, I don't think the Carolina media is asking Steve Wilkes that question.
Did he answer the question as if it was stupid?
No. No. I don't think he answers any question, you know, in a demeaning manner. Right. Yeah. Anything like that. He was very adamant that, like, I'm energized. Am I a little disappointed with how we've played? Yes. But I have a vision for the future, and as long as they want to interview me, I want to be in the interview process. So I think that's a question we have on the Saturday front that just needs to be answered. And we'll see. I don't know. Does a month from now, does his answer shift at all? The audio clip I want to play, Mark, cue up that Matt Ryan clip from yesterday. You know, I think you are facing a question with Matt Ryan of, like, does he want to play past this season? Again, I think he should be benched. I think he's looked old. I think he's struggled mightily. I don't think the Colts should bring him back, albeit the financial implications are pretty significant. And Matt Ryan made it very clear back in the spring that I want to play as long as I can. My body feels really good. You know, I still feel like I can play at as high a level as ever. And his play this year would certainly indicate otherwise. Here was Matt Ryan yesterday on if any thought has crept into his mind about next season.
You know, I've always tried to just handle the day, you know, that's in front of you. And particularly during the season, you know, it's one of those things that, you know, after the season, certainly as you get older, those are always discussions, you know, that you have to have and that you go through. But, you know, during the year, I think you try and, you know, make sure Wednesday is the best Wednesday it can be, or in today's case, Tuesday, you know, is the best Tuesday it can be. And so I don't go much further than that.
Jake, that sounds like a dude that's checked out.
That tone is far different than where he was in the spring.
That is a dude that's like, hell no, I got no interest in being here, man.
And I bring up his health because he's missed two games this year due to injury. He's been hit the most of his NFL career through whatever, 14 games. That is a far cry from what he was expecting coming into this season. And again, it's a far cry from his career. You know, if you look at his past, I think entering this season, you look at the previous 12 years, I think he'd missed one game due to injury. So this sounds harsh, but Jake, it would be a great scenario for the Colts if Matt Ryan decided to retire. Great news for the Colts.
You know what's, because this is a possibility, what I'm about to say. It's possible that Matt Ryan returns. I'm not saying it's probable, it's possible. It's possible that Jim Irsay falls in love with Jeff Saturday and hires him as the full-time coach. It's not probable, but it's possible. If that's the case, then that would mean that Chris Ballard is in what year as the general manager next season, Kevin? Would that be year six or seven?
Seven, yeah. 2017 is his
so
first
that would
year.
Mean that Chris Ballard would be 7 years in as a general manager of a National Football League team without having hired any of the three head coaches that worked underneath him or drafting a quarterback that was a primary starter. How sweet a gig is that? Like, how sweet a gig is that? You're a morning radio show host, but you never have to actually get up for the first hour, and you're only going to have to do things live, like, twice a week. Okay. I mean, the two biggest responsibilities, and they're not easy responsibilities, don't get me wrong. I mean, but the two biggest tests of a general manager that most face are hiring a coach or drafting a quarterback. And what a gig, man. What a gig.
Josh thinks the Colts ruined Matt Ryan. Is that right, Mark?
That's correct.
Josh, good morning.
Hey, guys. How you doing today?
Doing good. How about yourself?
Not bad. I just feel like we sold Matt Ryan a bunch of lies. You know, we were supposed to have this wonderful offensive line that we've seen has been terrible. I mean, the poor guy was getting just rocked every game. He looks like a dog that's been beat too many times at this point. Yeah. They didn't give him any help at receiver. They could have picked up Julio Jones, who we know was his safety blanket. They could have picked him up cheap. Not saying that he's a great receiver at this point, but once you have that rapport with somebody, and we saw it with Gronk and Brady. But do they not feel any responsibility for what they've done to this man? He's a Hall of Famer.
Yeah.
And now he's not. I feel like we ruined him.
Josh, I think we appreciate the call. I think we could debate the Hall of Fame aspect, but we don't need to do that today. The Colts did not support Matt Ryan. That is 1,000% true. To Josh's point, he's spot on with that. At the same time, I don't think Matt Ryan has carried his weight, because at some level, Jake, you pay that quarterback an absurd amount of money because he's supposed to lift the ship when needed. And he has not done that either. So I think both are true. Again,
I think what's going to be fun if he doesn't come back is to find out who the next 38-year-old is that we're expecting to lift weights, considering the fact that we're asking him to lift a level that they haven't actually seen in the weight room in like 5 years. You know? I mean, who's next?
Jared Goff.
If you're Detroit, don't you stick with Jared Goff? I mean, what's Joe Flacco doing? Has he got a year left in him? Let's bring him in. The hell, where's Mitchell Trubisky? Let's give him a call. We missed on him last time. He's handed the keys over to Pickett's little hands. Let's get him in here.
Matt Ryan turns 38 next year, 15 seasons in the NFL. Again, I know it probably sounds a little bit too harsh, but it would be great news for the Colts if he decided to retire.
If I'm Matt Ryan, I'm like, why would I go back? Right?
Well, there's some nice money on the table.
Well, that's true. But hey, does he need money at this point?
And again, he has been beat up this season, too. I mean, Josh had a very graphic explanation for that, but it is true. I mean, he has been beat up a lot more than he has really throughout his NFL career. We'll continue this conversation coming up. Stephen Holder joins us next. Again, Matt McKillop at 8:30. That's the Davidson head basketball coach. Purdue's got Davidson over at Gainbridge Fieldhouse coming up. Their first game for Purdue is ranked number one in the nation this season. Chris Denary in the 9 o'clock hour. We'll learn a little bit more about Ryan Walters coming up in the 9 o'clock hour as well. It is a dreary start to this Wednesday morning. Some rain was falling on our commute in. So, as Karen Query would want to inform, watch out for the wet leaves on this Wednesday morning. Kevin Query right here, 93.5, 107.5, The Fan.
Well, this is different. It's Saturday. On Saturday, the Colts play the Vikings in Minnesota Saturday. Matt Taylor has the kickoff at 1 o'clock on your home for the Colts, 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan. Indy's number one for new country.
I got some famous friends.
Nobody plays more new country. 97.1 Hank FM.
Guys, solve your ED today with an intimacy guarantee only at the Indianapolis Men's Clinic. If you don't perform, you don't pay. Call the Indianapolis Men's Clinic at 999-9000, 999-9000.
Affinity Whole Health is the leader in testosterone therapy. They'll find a testosterone program to help you feel amazing. Get started at feelgreatindy.com. That's feelgreatindy.com.
Enjoy all your favorite sports like never before at BetMGM. Sign up using the code The Fan, capital T, capital F, all one word, and your first wager is risk-free up to $1,000. When you register with BetMGM, you'll get instant access to a variety of parlay selection features, live betting options, player props, and daily boosted odds specials. With BetMGM at your fingertips, every game and every play matter more than ever. Sign up today and find out why nothing beats a win at the King of Sportsbooks. Download the BetMGM app today or go to BetMGM.com and again, enter that code THEFAN, all one word, and place your first wager risk-free. Visit BetMGM.com for terms and conditions. 21 years of age or older to wager. Indiana only. New customer offer. All promotions are subject to qualification and eligibility requirements. Rewards issued as non-withdrawable free bets or site credit. Free bets expire 7 days from issuance. If you or someone you know has a gambling problem and wants help, Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Diamonds. Everyone loves them, and at Chain Company, we've been experts in the diamond business since 1929. This means we know diamonds better than anyone else. At Chain Company, you can now choose between either a natural or lab-grown diamond for your engagement ring, diamond studs, or diamond pendant. When it comes to our new lab-grown diamonds, we take the same approach we do for all of our diamonds and apply our same superior standards. We work with the best diamond vendors, people who've perfected the art and science of creating gorgeous diamonds in a lab, with the quality we're known for. Then, we hand-select only the best stones cut by the best diamond cutters. Plus, all our diamonds are eligible for our free lifetime warranty and upgrades. We'll show you our huge selection in every price range and help you select the perfect diamond. No matter what you choose, whether it's a natural diamond or a lab-grown diamond, you can be confident that with Shane Company, you're getting the most beautiful diamond.
Now you have a friend in the jewelry business. Shane Company and ShaneCo.com.
Hi guys, it's Mark. Are you struggling with erectile dysfunction? Did you know that a major medical breakthrough is now available and it isn't a pill? Today, Wednesday, December 14th, we're running a one-day special you won't want to miss out on. Pine Grove Medical Clinic uses the most powerful form of wave therapy. This is a technology clinically shown to repair blood vessels and improve blood flow. It's backed by 60 clinical studies, including from Cambridge. If you're ready to regain the spark in your bedroom, today is your day. Call us now and you'll qualify for the assessment and ultrasound totally free. You'll also get a gift that can produce rapid and powerful results in the bedroom in minutes. You're going to love that one, guys. Trust me. And today only, we're offering 6 tune-up treatments to our patients free. This is an unprecedented offer worth hundreds of dollars, but call today and qualify totally free. Call 317-552-1111. That's 317-552-1111. Guys, put a stop to your erectile dysfunction and get your life back. Call Pine Grove Medical Clinic now to qualify. This offer ends today, Wednesday. 317-552-1111.
Ray Magliotta here for eBay Motors. Okay, easy now. You're teaching your kid how to parallel park. Ouch! Turns out he likes to do it by feel. Don't worry, eBay Motors has bumpers, taillights, trunk lids, license plate holders, 122 million parts. Pull up just a little bit. And headlights. They've got lots of headlights. Get the right parts at the right prices. eBay Motors, let's ride.
Get in zone, AutoZone.
Welcome to AutoZone. What are you working on today? Ah, starting trouble. No one likes that. We'll get you set up for some stronger starts. You might just need a fresh charge, and we'll take care of that free of charge.
But if it is time for a new battery, we've got replacement batteries that'll fit your needs, starting at just $79.99. You can learn more about our battery selection at AutoZone.com. That's what makes us America's number one battery destination.
Get in zone, AutoZone.
Claim based on data from the NPD Group 2021.
Gather near and bring the cheer this holiday season. Dazzle and delight the love of your life with a gift from Helzberg Diamonds. Don't miss great prices on stunning diamond studs, tennis bracelets, gemstone rings, and the year's must-have look, gold jewelry for stacking and layering. Another reason to go to Helzberg? Get a free Microsoft Surface Laptop Go with a purchase of $1,699 or more. Visit Helzberg.com or a store near you today. Limited time offer while supplies last. See online or in store for details.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
The Chicago Bears take on the Philadelphia Eagles. Sunday at noon on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan. Break them.
You're listening to Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
8 o'clock hour is underway. Jake Querry along with Kevin Bowen. Mark Dykton has finished his 12th cereal bar this morning and is here with us as well. He has dialed up for us on the Payless Cigars hotline, our friend from ESPN.com, Stephen Holder, who covers the Indianapolis Colts. Stephen, I'm going to get right to this with you. One of your colleagues at ESPN had a mock draft. I'm not sure who it was that wrote it, but had the Colts drafting 7th. That obviously is fluid. But with it, had the Colts taking an offensive lineman out of Northwestern, who I know is a dynamic, foreseen to be a dynamic player. But do you really see a possibility, if the Colts are drafting inside of the top 10, that they once again bypass quarterback?
Well, I think I saw that mock draft. I think that scenario that was presented there had I believe, the top three quarterbacks off the board already. Will Levis, I think, being maybe the sixth overall pick, I think, in that scenario. I think it was Todd McShay, if I'm not mistaken. And so I think under that scenario, it becomes tricky. And this is one of those scenarios that we will dig further into, you know, as we get closer, because these are going to be the realities, I think, that they'll have to face is, you know, what happens if those top two quarterbacks we think are going to go, you know, somewhere in the top five, right? And then it becomes a question of where does the next quarterback go? You know, if in fact it becomes a group of three at the very top of the draft, which is where we think it is right now. It's very, very early, okay? Let's be clear. And a lot of these projections change drastically from December to, like, you know, March and April. But I do think that's a possible, you know, a possible outcome that the Colts are going to have to face. You know, if the top quarterbacks are gone, what do they do? And if they're not high enough in the draft, and their position could also change, right? So that's the other factor here. So I don't think it's a matter under that scenario of bypassing quarterback. I think it's more a matter of the quarterbacks that are worthy of being taken in that at that level being gone, and then what do they do? And that's a very real problem. And that's why, you know, this draft is not necessarily going to be one that solves all their problems. And that's something that I've kind of tried to convey to fans. I don't think we can assume that, you know, I just don't think we can assume this draft is going to solve all of their problems, you know, because they're not going to have, you know, a top two or three pick. And then you never know where that leaves you.
Yeah, and if you look, you know, into the third round, that Washington pick is going to be a lot deeper into the third round than you were hoping compared to where your third round pick would have been. Again, Stephen Holder with us from ESPN.com. On the quarterback front, Stephen, you know, I felt like the Matt Ryan tone was a little bit different yesterday in answering the question about the thought of 2023 and playing out his contract versus where it was in the spring. And maybe that shouldn't be a surprise. I mean, he's been beat up this year, and it's a season that he definitely wasn't expecting. Have you gotten any sense or any impression that he might hang it up?
I haven't. No, not specifically. I mean, I think there's the obvious, right, which is how he's playing and his standing with the team in the long term, which can't be great. You know, certainly they have some decisions to make at quarterback, but no, I haven't gotten that impression. I think the reality with Matt Ryan, I think if he's a businessman and he's played long enough that I think that he is, the reality is that if he's smart, he's just going to wait it out and let the Colts make the decision for him. And the reason I say that is because if he retires, I believe he would have to forego some of that guaranteed money that he's owed. I believe the $7 million bonus, I believe it's $7 million, and I think there's some other sum of money that may or may not be forfeited as well if he retires. I have to confirm
that. Yeah, I think
that,
it's like a $10 million bonus. I want to say that is maybe roster bonus, and then the $7 million is his salary bonus. So, yeah, 17 total.
Right. So, I mean, that money's guaranteed. But if I understand it correctly, it's guaranteed if he's on the roster at a certain date.
Yeah, come March.
And so, right. So, and if they cut him, I think they still owe that money, if I'm not mistaken. I should have confirmed a lot more of this before we had this conversation. But the point is, I'm pretty certain that money's owed to him if he's cut, because I think that trigger has already come in terms of the guarantee. For the Colts, the decisions on them, I think if you're Matt Ryan, you want them to make the decision is what I'm saying. I mean, at minimum, even if the roster bonus doesn't come, I think if the roster bonus doesn't get paid, there's still guarantees in the salary that he would be owed. So, yeah, just from a business perspective, you got to wait on them if you're Matt Ryan. I know he's made plenty of money, and he's just fine, and he's not going to miss that money. But it's yours, right? So I think that's how I would play it. I'm sure that's how his agent will tell him to play it. And then there's also a separate matter, which is what you're really getting at in terms of, you know, what does he want to do? And I still think he's that competitor that he's always been. But this season has taken a lot out of Matt Ryan. There's no doubt about that. And maybe that's what you're kind of hearing. You know, maybe that's what you're picking up on. And I imagine he's kind of processing a lot, you know, that's happened this year.
Steven, I'm going to ask a broken record question, and I apologize for asking a broken record question. But and I don't know that any of us know definitively, so I want your take on it. Between Chris Ballard, Jim Irsay, Jeff Saturday, I'll throw Matt Ryan in the hopper because quarterback's the most important position in sports. Do you feel like everybody, in terms of the direction, the goal in mind, the vision for the remainder of this season, is everyone within the Colts boardroom on the same page?
I think so. I can tell you that Chris Ballard, for example, and I talked to someone recently who would know, and he has been beside himself, you know, in terms of, you know, having to deal with losses. And look, let me tell you, Chris Ballard sat within earshot of me and the other Indianapolis Riders during the Dallas game. Okay. And if you think this guy wants to lose, then I would give you my seat for like 5 minutes in that press box, and you would come away with a much different tone. Let me tell you, I'll leave it at that. I won't get into particulars, but listen, that guy was miserable. Okay. So he wants to win. There's no question about that. And he just can't stomach losing. Jim Irsay, I think parts of Jim Irsay understand the business of football for sure. Right. I mean, he's on this team for a long time, but Jim Irsay is the biggest fan of all. Okay. He's the biggest fan of all and hates to lose. So, you know, and then there's Jeff Saturday, who he has no clue if he's going to be here next year. He could care less, couldn't care less. I caught myself. See?
There you go.
I almost said
should of,
that,
right?
That's a pet peeve of mine. He couldn't care less about draft position. It's probably not even going to be his problem. Okay? So, yeah, I think if you're talking about, if that's what you're getting at, right, when you say are the goals aligned, if you're talking about, you know, whether they're actually trying to win or whether there's any active tanking involved. There may be some passive tanking. I don't know. But, no, there's not. They're trying to win, and I think there's just a lot of pride involved for everybody involved right now. So they're trying to win. They're just not doing a good job of it.
Steven Holder with us from ESPN.com. Steven, Jeff Saturday, I thought I had, you know, a good amount of conviction yesterday behind the answer on if he wants to coach full time. You know, it almost seems like that is a question that has to be asked. I mean, this is new to Jeff Saturday. It's a, you know, totally kind of foreign experience from what he was used to or what he was previously doing. Any surprise at all about just how much conviction he had and how adamant he was of, yes, I want to interview for this full-time gig?
Well, first of all, I mean, you ripped the Band-Aid off pretty good there, and I'm glad you did, because by asking that question, because I'm not going to lie. I mean, I was kind of wondering, and I think the question for us was kind of like, all right, when do we go there? And maybe after a 25-point loss to Dallas is a good time to do it. So
yeah, I was like a little more post-bye week, but yeah.
No, that's fine. That's fine. So, yeah, I thought his answer, number one, I appreciate the direct answer, because I thought he could have tiptoed around it, right? He could have just been like, you know, I'm just focused on today.
All right, I got to talk with my family at the end of the season, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, because normally that's the answer you get on those situations. To just credit, and this is very helpful if you're a sports writer, you want a direct answer, and we got one. I thought his answer was not stunning, but I thought surprisingly and refreshingly honest. I thought that when he came into this, you know, he said he wanted to do this long term, but I don't know if I fully believed it, because I thought it was just kind of like an experiment for him. You know what I'm saying? It's like, Jim Irsay asked. I said, what the heck? You know, part of me wondered if this wasn't deep down inside like an experiment for Jeff Saturday. You know what I'm saying? And I thought he put that to rest by giving the answer that he did. He's like, hey, I'm here. I want to do this. He was very specific when he said, I have a vision for what this could look like in the future. He didn't get into what that is, but that tells me he's thinking about, you know, what he would do if he is the coach in the long term. So I liked his answer. I would probably go a different direction, but I mean, certainly some of the shine has been lost, right, this past month, but I love the direct answer.
Steven, I can't even believe I'm about to ask this.
Oh, boy. Let me put my seatbelt on.
That's right. Is Jacksonville going to sneak in and make things interesting down the home stretch of the AFC South?
I don't know, but I'm here for it. I don't know what's up. First of all, the Titans are a mess. I don't know what's going on there. I haven't seen Jacksonville play a lot in recent weeks, but this is kind of what I thought was possible, because Doug Peterson's a good coach. And it's not like they're completely devoid of talent. I mean, they had multiple number one overall picks, okay? And so, and one of them is their quarterback, who's starting to, you know, perform better, right? And starting to look like a little more like the guy we thought he could be, functional. And I think their defense, it's not very consistent, but it's talented in spots. So, yeah, I mean, if the door remains open, who knows, man? I tell you that, and I think there's a lesson here if you're a Colts fan. I haven't answered your question directly, but I don't know the answer, but I think it would certainly be very interesting, right? But the lesson here for the Colts fan, if you are one, is that the years ahead, okay, the years to come, could be very different, man. I mean, they're in a tough spot here if they don't fix this quarterback situation. And in the other variable is that, you know, some of their better players, you know, they're in their prime. They're going to be coming out of their prime, you know, before you know it, right? So where are the Colts in the long term in this whole mix, you know? And then you have Houston over here who's going to get their quarterback of the future. Maybe they get it right this time, right? Who knows? And who knows what that means for their franchise. So the AFC South is not a great division right now and doesn't look good. Nothing looks good in the AFC South right
with
now.
With all the teams in the AFC South getting, you know, they're all stuck in this quicksand of suck, right? And Jacksonville looks like they're kind of maybe getting their ankle free. But does that cause Jim Irsay to look at it and say, hell yeah, we're still in this thing? Or does it cause Jim Irsay to pound the table harder and say, it is absurd that we're not in this hunt?
Probably the latter right now, because the reason I say that is because even if they're mathematically alive, I mean, what are you hanging your hat on, right? At some point, you can't just be mathematically alive. You have to show a pulse, right? You have to show that you're capable of taking advantage of that window being open. The window's open, and they're just sitting there looking at the window. They're not actually climbing through it in any form or fashion. So, I mean, if it's me, my reaction would be, man, what a blown opportunity, you know? And as you said, they're varying degrees of suck in division right now, and the Colts are sucking to a very high degree. No question about that.
Colts would be eliminated in any other division in the AFC right now, but the AFC South just offers that nice sliver of hope here. T.Y. Hilton, Steven, joining Dallas. Again, Steven Holder, ESPN.com with us. Do you think the Colts were ever close at all with T.Y. Hilton this offseason? We know Jim Irsay kind of sweetened the pot in 2021 to bring T.Y. Hilton back, but do you think there was ever any serious talks with him?
Okay, so I actually have some information on this. My understanding in the last couple of days, in fact, was that they were closer than you think to making it happen back in, I don't know, maybe training camp, I guess. It was a serious conversation, and it almost happened. They couldn't come to terms, is my understanding.
So this would have been for the start of the season. He would have played, you know, week one.
Not recently. Yeah, this would have been back, I believe, in August, is my understanding. That's how I interpreted what I was told. So certainly not in recent weeks or months. This was before the regular season, okay? So they were definitely talking. I mean, we knew they were talking. I mean, Chris Ballard told us they had been in contact throughout the offseason. But in the end, they just couldn't come to terms on the money and just couldn't get it done. And I don't know what the numbers were. I'm not even going to speculate. I have no idea. But that's what it was. And that doesn't stun me, because I'll tell you why. I think for the Colts, it was kind of, I don't want to say luxury, you know, because I think they could have definitely used him. But I don't think they saw it as urgent on their behalf. So the offer likely reflected that, you know, whatever it was. Again, I don't know the numbers, but I think whatever it was reflected, you know, the Colts' opinion of how necessary it was to have T.Y. Hilton on their roster. And so, I mean, if you're T.Y. from his perspective, you know, you're thinking, okay, well, I've earned some respect from this team, and I want a certain number, right? And also, if you're a veteran of his age who has made a lot of money, you know, it's got to be worth it to you, you know? So I have no idea what the money ended up being in Dallas. It's not going to be a lot, right? It's December. But I think that's less about money and more about opportunity, chase a ring, et cetera, unique opportunity for a guy who's, you know, not won a lot of tangible rewards in his career.
So, Steven, based on the fact that seemingly the Colts did not go out and I'm going off memory here, so correct me if I'm wrong, but in that time period, it's not like they went out and signed a veteran receiver, right?
Right.
So would that have been basically the pursuit of T.Y. Hilton, would that have been almost like a ceremonial signing? In other words, it's not like because they didn't come to terms with him, they went elsewhere and that was a need that they felt they had to address, and he just happened to be the guy, right? Is that a fair statement?
That is true, yes. I mean, I think it was a couple of things. They were comfortable with him. He would certainly give them a leadership role in a very young unit. There's no question about that. He also, I think there was maybe some element of, you know, ceremonial to some extent, right? Just because, you know, look, he's almost at 10,000 yards and, you know, that's a big milestone. I mean, I think that's all of it is the reason why, right? I don't think there's any single reason. And just the obvious too, right? They were very young in that room. And I think there were a lot of questions coming into the season. I'll give Chris Ballard some credit. I don't have a huge problem with the wide receivers. I think they've done fine. I think their bigger problem has been at quarterback and offensive line and the collective performance there. The wide receivers, I don't think they're the issue. So I think they got one thing right in terms of the areas where they took some leaps. They took a lot of leaps, like left tackle and so forth. But that leap that they took, I think it worked out fine. But we didn't know that at the time, and this is the day, you know. So I think that was kind of where their thinking was.
Off to Minnesota this weekend. Again, it's a 1 o'clock tip come or 1 o'clock tip, 1 o'clock kick coming up this Saturday. NFL Network, I think locally, Fox 59, along with obviously on these airwaves. Steven, safe travels here. Safe travels to New York coming up around the new year. And thanks as always.
All right, guys. Happy holidays.
Steven Holder right there on the Payless Liquors hotline. He said something early on, Jake, that I think is worth going back to of you can't solve anything or you can't solve everything in this draft. It's obviously true when you only are picking once in round one, once in round two. Like I said, you don't have your third round pick. You have Washington's third round pick this year. It's why, Jake, I think one of the biggest, honestly, probably the biggest storyline for the final four games of the season. Does Bernard Raimann look like your left tackle of the future? I think if you talk to some people offensive line related, they would say that he's made some strides in a positive direction here as of late. If you feel like at the end of the year, which is no slam dunk, that he is your left tackle of the future and that pans out, that is a huge, 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 cannot stress that enough, piece to the puzzle that has been missing since Anthony Costanza retired.
Correct.
But, and that would do wonders for your football team.
But, you know, if you look at Anthony Costanzo, Kevin.
In addressing quarterback, of course.
Did Costanzo look like your left tackle of the future and your pillar after one season?
He did not, which does that offer you hope with Raimann?
And you know,
now, granted, Costanzo was drafted, what, 21 overall or something, and Bernard Raimann was 90th overall?
Yeah, but Raimann was also thought to be somebody that could potentially have been taken in. In other words, if you would have taken Raimann in the late first, early second, I don't know that it would have been completely torched, right? He was kind of seen in that area.
Yeah. But that is, again, I think that individual storyline is absolutely critical to keep an eye on.
The front office was hoping for Bernard Raimann.
I'm Bernard Raimann, and I'll be back.
That pause gets me every time.
It's perfect.
So good.
It was very well executed.
I mean, he could be an actor, right? Post-playing career?
Have the Dick Butkus career? Or...
Sure. Yeah.
Alex Karras? 1,000%.
Yeah, there you go.
Mark, we've got Matt McKillop, is that right, coming up next?
Mm-hmm.
Davidson head coach. So he took over for his dad, right?
Bob was
the longtime Davidson head coach.
His first season as the Davidson head coach. I believe they're 7-3. He also has a connection to Central Indiana that I find fascinating.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
I have a feeling you'll bring that up with him coming up in a few minutes. So we'll do that in about 5 minutes. Let's do a morning checkdown.
The Morning Checkdown, brought to you by Ball State Basketball. Get your tickets at ballstatesports.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
Last night in the NBA, it was Milwaukee 128-111 over the Warriors of Golden State. Giannis had 30 and 12. Steph Curry had 20. The big news there, Kevin, is that begins the watch. Does Steph Curry, does Draymond Green, does Klay Thompson, or do, I should say, any of them sit out tonight as Pacers and Warriors at the Fieldhouse?
Yeah, you know, if you look at Vegas, they've got the line at 1.5, Pacers underdog. That would probably indicate they believe some of these guys are going to sit out. You're going back and looking at the Warriors this season with back-to-backs. Klay Thompson has sat out every single one of them. Steph and Draymond, about half of them. Again, the good news for Pacers fans or fans of Steph Curry that are going to be in the building tonight, and I don't know, maybe I would think Pacers fans would rather be entertained by Steph Curry than get a resting Warriors team. But they barely played in the fourth quarter. So did that change Steve Kerr's plans at all with this back-to-back? Again, nothing on that front just yet. We'll keep you posted if we hear anything throughout the morning. But Pacers and Warriors tonight at 7. Jake, yesterday in the World Cup, you've got Argentina advancing to the final. That means Lionel Messi, and I would assume if you are a member of the Fox TV ratings people, you're probably very happy. I would think Lionel Messi will be a nice draw for the final there. So that is one half of it. The other half we'll find out today. France versus the Cinderella story of Morocco.
Again, Morocco, that Mark, you said that's the first French nation in the semifinals, right?
First African nation.
Sorry, we were saying that earlier they have French influence. First African nation in the semifinals. That would mean that they would be the first French in the finals, right? Or African in the finals. Why do I keep saying French?
I don't know.
I'm kind of glad he butchered that after he tried to pull out the same joke.
It's not a joke. I'm being serious. I'm just saying it's deductive.
Call me Shirley.
By the way, college basketball, Indiana and Kansas. That game Saturday at noon, Allen Fieldhouse in Lawrence. It will be Purdue taking on Davidson. That is part of the Indy Classic. That game here in Indianapolis, the Boilers are ranked number one overall, and we're going to get
the Lawyer brothers, right?
Glimpse on the other side of the curtain, right?
Fletcher versus Foster Lawyer in that matchup. Yeah, just one note before we get to Matt McKillop again coming up in a few minutes. Ryan Walters, the new Purdue head football coach, he will meet the media around noon today. It is a 5-year deal for him. 36 years old, fourth youngest head coach right now in college football. And he checked the box on day one duties. Get the viral video out there and handing a scholarship to Devin Mockbee. I loved Mockbee's reaction, just like hands in the air.
The fact that Mockbee wasn't on scholarship has to be bewildering to everyone.
You know, part of me thought when Brom left, like if I were Mike Babinski, that awkward like week period, I don't know if he has the clout to do this, I just would have given Mockbee a scholarship then.
Yeah, it's very odd. Why do I keep saying French for Morocco?
Allen, Purdue young quarterback, sounds like he's sticking around.
The upset, is that why?
I don't know what it is about Morocco that like is emblazed in my head that there's a French. I know that they have French influence, but
I do believe a good amount of their lineup has some European dual citizenship. So maybe that's playing into it. I don't know. Trying to predict your brains, like trying to predict Jim Irsay's brain at times.
Here's my partner,
Matt McKillop. Davidson, Davidson head basketball coach, joins us next.
It's the Colts VIP tailgate presented by Hayes & Sons Restoration. Make your game day experience the best it can be. Log on and get your tickets now. It's BullseyeEventGroup.com.
Football season is underway, so now is the perfect time to download FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. Because right now, new customers get a no-sweat first bet up to $1,000. Just sign up with promo code PLAY. FanDuel has all your favorite bets from the money line to point spreads to player props. So sign up today with promo code PLAY for your no-sweat first bet. Make every moment more this season with FanDuel, official sportsbook partner of the NFL.
21 plus in select states. First online real money wager only. Refund issued as non-withdrawable free bets that expires in 14 days. Restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.fanduel.com. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER or visit fanduel.com/RG in Colorado, Iowa, Michigan, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Illinois, and Virginia. 1-800-NEXT-STEP or text NEXT-STEP to 53342 in Arizona. 1-888-789-7777 or visit ccpg.org/chat in Connecticut. 1-800-9-WITH-IT in Indiana. 1-800-522-4700 or visit ksgamblinghelp.com in Kansas. 1-877-770-STOP Louisiana. 1-877-8-HOPE-NY or text HOPE-NY-467-369 in New York. Tennessee Red Line 1-800-889-9789 in Tennessee. 1-800-522-4700 in Wyoming or visit 1-800-GAMBLER.net in West Virginia.
You know, if you wrote down all that legal jargon right there, you might have joint pain in your wrist. Good news, though. That's where QC Kinetics can help you out. If you're dealing with any sort of joint pain, you need to call QC Kinetics. They are the nation's leader in regenerative medicine, giving lasting relief with no surgery, no drugs, and no downtime. We're talking modern advances in regenerative medicine that allow the medical professionals to take the remarkable healing properties from your own body, concentrate them for maximum power, and then put them directly into your aching joints so your damaged tissue can be repaired and restored naturally. So many people are living their best life again, pain-free, thanks to QC Kinetics. Again, if you've got pain in your knees, hips, shoulder, they'll let them tell you that steroids or surgery are your only options. Give QC Kinetics a call for a free consultation. It's 463-235-7160. Locations in Eagle Creek and Greenwood. QC Kinetics, 463-235-7160.
This holiday season, DraftKings Sportsbook app is giving Indiana Pacers fans a special gift. Everyone can get a no-sweat bet on every Pacers game this December. Head to the DraftKings Sportsbook app, opt in under the promos tab, and place an eligible bet of your choice on a Pacers game. If it doesn't hit, you'll get your money back in a free bet. With payouts bigger than ever, DraftKings Sportsbook app is the place to go to bet on the NBA. Download the DraftKings Sportsbook app now. New customers can sign up with a promo code 1075FAN and get a no-sweat bet on every Pacers game this December. Go to the DraftKings Sportsbook app and opt in today to receive this limited-time offer only at DraftKings Sportsbook, an official sports betting partner of the Indiana Pacers. Must be 21 or older, Indiana only. Max reward limits apply. One free bet issued based on amount of initial losing bet. Eligibility restrictions apply. See terms at sportsbook.draftkings.com/basketball terms. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-9-WITH-IT.
Well, this is different. It's Saturday. On Saturday, the Colts play the Vikings in Minnesota Saturday. Matt Taylor has the kickoff at 1 o'clock on your home for the Colts. 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan. Indy's number one for new country. Nobody plays more new country. 97.1 Hank FM.
LL Cool J is hard as hell. Battle anybody, I don't care. You tell, I excel. They all fail. Gonna cocktail double.
You're listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
A lot of Davidson Wildcats in Indianapolis here over the next couple of days. Steph Curry and the Warriors tonight. And then on Saturday, it is the Indy Classic. Ball State at 6-4 with Michael Lewis's team on a two-game win streak, taking on Illinois State at 3:30. Then after that, it's the number one team in the land, the Boilermakers of Purdue, taking on Davidson. Joining us now on the Payless Liquors Hotline, he is in, I believe, his 14th season on staff at Davidson, his first as the head coach. Matt McKillop joins us to talk about that particular game. Coach, first off, good morning to you. Appreciate you getting up early with us.
Yeah, good morning. Great to be on with you guys.
You sound wide awake. Are you like a coffee latte guy? What time do you wake up in the morning?
It all depends on my household. I've got a 5-year-old, a 3-year-old, and my wife and I have a 3-month-old baby boy. So there's little sleep going on right now. I'm usually having to find my way to be wide awake.
Boy, there's a three-month-old in my house. Thoughts and prayers with you.
Oh, thanks.
Coach, how did this game come about? Obviously, we are used to the Crossroads Classic here in Indiana-Purdue, Butler-Notre Dame for about a decade, and then You know, it seemed like there was interest from Purdue to maintain some sort of Indy presence. How did you guys come to be? Was the lawyer connection part of the reason that you wanted to schedule this game?
That had a lot to do with it, yeah. And, you know, as you mentioned, I just took over as head coach and recently, and, you know, end of June was when I was named head coach. But as an assistant for the last several years, one of my responsibilities was putting together our non-conference schedule. So we always do whatever we can to find Power 5 teams, top 25 teams, you know, the most highly ranked teams we can play to compete against. And it's challenging for us to find teams that will play us, you know, on a home court at our place. Usually they want to play only a game, you know, a money game on their home court. And I reached out to somebody on the Purdue staff, you know, sometime early last basketball season and mentioned that, hey, with Foster lawyer here and Fletcher lawyer there, is this something that could be of interest to you guys? And then a couple weeks later, I got a call about this event and you know, the Crossroads Classic coming to an end, but some type of similar doubleheader being played, and Davidson versus Purdue being an option. And I think the lawyer piece to it was what was attractive to us, but also attractive to them, and it made sense, and we were excited to be a part of it.
Which has caused you to stay awake late at night in the last week with more frequency, having a three-month-old or figuring out what to do against number one Purdue and Zach Edey?
I would say my three-month-old is pretty tame compared to what Zach Edey is currently doing on the court across the college basketball world. He's terrific. You know, when my first year actually on staff at Davidson, we played Purdue in Indy. And we had Steph Curry, and they had Jawan Johnson, Etwan Moore, Robbie Hummel, Chris Kramer. They were really good, and I was tasked with being one of the coaches doing the scout. And right away, I my eyes were open to the kind of type of coach that Matt Painter is, and the way he can get his team to play, the style of their offense, and just how challenging it is to guard. We played them again a few years ago down in the Charleston Classic as well. So no surprise that Coach Painter has been able to take a freshman backcourt, put him together with a I say developing, only because his production last year was, you know, minimal, if you will, compared to what he's doing right now. But no surprise at all that Coach Painter has figured out a way to make this team the best team in the country.
Coach, I wanted you to give kind of a perspective for people listening. Matt McKillop is our guest, the head coach at Davidson. You were an assistant, as you mentioned, when Steph Curry was there. And, you know, there are people listening right now that might have a young person in the household that's an aspiring athlete, or maybe young people are listening. Steph Curry was the son of an NBA player, but he was probably thought coming out of high school to be a little bit undersized. And there probably would have been a lot of motivation in him to say, you know, why am I not at one of the big Power Fives? I mean, that is no disrespect to Davidson, but just based on his pedigree, what did you see out of him in terms of his work ethic or preparation to get him to the point where he is now that could be a lesson for young people?
So I'll preface with this is I just stayed out of his way. He was that exceptional. And I was only on staff for his last year at Davidson, so I was not necessarily a part of the recruiting process. I was actually on the Davidson team when he visited as a member of the team. But what I saw the 1 year I was on staff with him, I'm sorry, the 1 year I was on staff and he was on the team, was he had an unbelievable daily approach, and it was regimented, and he took it seriously, and it wasn't just rolling the ball out and getting a few shots up. Like he was intentional about what he did when he stepped on the court every day as a 21 year old. But what sets him apart now, which is who he also was as a college player, which I imagine he did as a high school, an AAU player, was he had this mental capacity to live in the moment unlike anybody you'll ever see. He could make a mistake and it would not affect his next possession. He could miss a shot. He could turn the ball over. He could get beat defensively. But he was able to perform that next possession as if it was the first possession, as if he was, you know, starting from scratch. And you know, it sounds so simple, it sounds so easy, but that is a challenge that I deal with, that our players deal with, that you want to be able to give them like this magic potion that they can drink and all of a sudden be able to perform like that. But he has an unbelievable ability to live in the moment, to play in the moment, and to not let anything affect him.
Again, it's going to be Dave. Sorry about that, Coach. It's going to be Davidson and Purdue coming up Saturday evening over at Gainbridge Fieldhouse. I want to go back to something that you mentioned earlier just about facing Purdue. How do you replicate Zach Edey in practice? I'm like you know, picturing scenes from the movie of like, yeah, here's our tallest head coach with a broom and, you know.
Like Ollie getting on the shoulders, right?
Sure, yeah. Like, I'm picturing a little bit of that. Can you and how do you simulate, you know, what is probably the most unique matchup in college basketball?
Yeah, it's what I would say, and I'll put it this way. So we're in exams right now. So we played last Wednesday. We had a few off days. We practiced over the weekend. We were off the last 2 days. Now we're going to be full boat into practice preparation for Purdue. And we treated our previous practices less about our next opponent. It was more about us and what we needed to do to get better, with a little sprinkle in a few subtle things about Purdue in there without our players maybe realizing it, because we were really working on ourselves. But in my opinion, it's more about when he catches the ball, there's so little that you can actually do when he catches it in the right spot. So you don't really need a 7-foot-4 person on the court necessarily. It's more about keeping everybody who could possibly be close to that size on our team or on our scout team away from certain spots on the court and making things difficult for them. I don't think anybody in the country can replicate it. And we do have a really tall freshman, and by really tall, he's going to be dwarfed by Zach Edey, who we're thinking, hey, should we put him on scout team? And he's not someone you'd want on scout team. We want him playing, getting reps, because he's going to contribute minutes, as he has in almost every game this year. But yeah, we're probably going to have one of our assistant coaches who's maybe 5'11", 6 foot tall, but he's got some strength and some size to maybe play post position. He'll replicate him as best he can, because it's the best option we have on our team. And I know it's going to feel quite a bit different when we go up for the jump ball on Saturday. But yeah, I think the question you ask is what everybody will struggle with as they go through the year and they prepare for Purdue. How can you replicate that? And I don't think you can.
All right, New Zealand, Switzerland, Italy, Iceland. It's a hell of an international recruiting budget here for the Davidson roster. I assume that's a pretty conscious effort. You guys strike me as a very intelligent school. I don't think it's a very big school, if I'm not mistaken, but I assume there's a conscious effort in trying to get some international flavor.
Yeah, so like you mentioned, we're not a very big school. We have 2,000 students. We're all undergraduate. It's a residential campus, so it's pretty unique in the landscape of Division I college athletics. And it's a rigorous academic school, so it's challenging. It's you know, we like to compare ourselves to the Ivy League schools in terms of the reputation our degree has and the quality of the students that we have to recruit. And for years, when my father, Bob McKillop, who was the previous head coach, was trying to build the program, and he was the head coach for 33 years, so he figured out ways to try to find players anywhere and everywhere that would, one, be interested in coming to Davidson, but two, would have the academic credentials to not only get into Davidson, but to thrive once they got here. So he, you know, was uncovering every stone and turning over every stone to try to find those prospects. And we found ourselves going to Europe and looking internationally quite a bit. And it's been great for us. And last year we started 3 international players. We've had 2 players of the year in the last 4 years that were, one was from Iceland, one was from Austria in the Atlantic 10. So I believe that international players have a familiarity of Davidson because of Steph and Curry. And when they look a little closer in the recruiting process, they see some other people who've paved that same path and made the decision to go across the ocean to have a basketball career. And they've seen other international players succeed at Davidson and perform well and be productive. And I think they're attracted to that. So it's something I believe we're going to continue to do.
Coach, I wanted to touch on this as well, to kind of bring an Indiana tie into this. When you talk about international, you know, obviously this was not a recruiting trip, but rather a trip for the growth of your young men, and perhaps for all of you that partook in it. Back in 2018, if I'm not mistaken, Eva Kor, who was an Indiana native, well, not an Indiana native, but an Indiana resident, obviously,
yeah.
Who was Romanian and was in Auschwitz as a young girl along with her twin sister and survived the Holocaust, and then became essentially the face of educating people about the Holocaust, took your basketball team or accompanied your basketball team in 2018 to what had to be an incredibly powerful journey. Can you talk about that trip that you were on as an assistant, what it meant for your players, and just how it all came together and what you left there, what came with you from that?
Yeah, I'll do my best, because it was a moving, emotional trip, and I, you know, it's tough to say it's a great experience, because you go and you see such atrocity when you walk around Auschwitz. And funny enough, right before getting on this call, I got an email from from Alex Kor, who's Eva's son. And I'm not sure if you're aware, but Eva's husband is, I think he's a Purdue. He unfortunately passed away last year, but he's a crazy Boilermaker fan.
Correct.
So you're familiar with everything there. But I got an email from Alex. I know he's going to be at the game, and he's become a really good friend of mine and our programs. The trip came about, in some kind of unique ways. We have a Davidson alum who's on the board of an organization that's a Holocaust remembrance organization, and they were trying to put together a trip for a younger group. So because, as every year goes by, there's less and less Holocaust survivors, unfortunately, and there's this fear that left away, and they want to continue to educate the younger generations about what happened. So that's how we were able to go over there. And as you know, every college team can take an international trip every 4 years. And we were able to get a waiver from the NCAA because we weren't going to play basketball at all. In fact, we were only there for 3 nights. It was amazing for all the ways that you could be touched and you could be moved and you could see resilience from people like Eva, who was a child when she was there. And she was torn away from her mother, and she showed us that place in that moment where she saw her mother for the last time. And it was to have her tell our team this and to have such positivity about everything she did, and she toured us around. I mean, it was an experience that we will all carry with us, I think, forever. And we got to spend time with her, and she's 80 years old, and she's gone through the worst thing in the world. And, she can relate to a 18, 19 year old college basketball player who comes from a completely different background. And it just shows you what being positive, what working together, what being a part of a group who has the will to survive and a will to do something bigger than themselves. It just, I don't know. It's something that you could take with you, forever, I guess. So that's maybe my best answer, and I don't know I can ever do justice to an answer like that, because what we saw was horrible, but what we got to experience being with Eva was incredible.
Well, I think
what an experience.
Yeah, jeez. And wow. And I think both of the Kors, Eva and her husband, certainly I know that Alex's father, Eva's husband, was indeed a huge Purdue fan, a big fan of Matt Painter. And John Wooden, for that matter, who had played at Purdue. But I got a feeling, Coach, they're going to be watching this game from above and probably rooting for both teams, right, as a result of that, because that's an experience and a bond that I think is very special, and there's a lot of respect there, I think. So, I'm glad you guys were able to make that trip with them.
Yeah, well, I'm thankful you brought it up. That was a great memory, despite the word "great" not being a great characteristic for what we saw. But I appreciate you bringing up our relationship with that family, because they're special.
He is Matt McKillop again. The Davidson Wildcats coming to Indianapolis this Saturday, approximately about 6:15 tip. Purdue and Davidson after Illinois State and Ball State over at Gainbridge Fieldhouse. Coach, I think it's a fun matchup. Obviously, a unique angle with the Lawyer brothers watching. Foster this year and Fletcher, both of them have been extremely impressive in their own right, and certainly that family's got to be pretty proud of how both of those guys have played this season. So safe travels up here to Indy, and good luck.
Well, thanks so much, guys. Appreciate you having me on.
That's Matt McKillop right there, the head coach again of the Davidson Wildcats on the Payless Liquors hotline. I totally had forgotten about that Steph Curry game over at Gainbridge Fieldhouse, or Banker's Life, I guess it would have been back then.
Chris Kramer was all over.
I was
going
to say Kramer was outstanding. And I remember back in the day, Ronald Norred. Remember they used to do that bracket buster?
Yeah.
Like the mid-major teams would face off in February to try to improve their resume. I remember Norred doing a great job down at Davidson in a matchup against Steph Curry back in the day. So, ironically, as you mentioned to him, Jake, Steph Curry in the building tonight. We'll continue to keep you posted
so
on.
So, too, will be Ronald Norred, by the way.
He is going to play. Correct. Ronald Norred, of course. Very energized coach on the sidelines, Ronald Norred.
He is clearly their defensive coach.
There are times I'm like, is he past midcourt?
He is
to make sure they are locked in.
Their defensive coach. He's constantly yelling, especially at Isaiah Jackson.
Yes,
move over!
Yeah. He is the defensive coordinator, to say the least. We'll talk a little bit about Ryan Walters, Purdue new head football coach. When we come back, Chris Denary joins us in the 9 o'clock hour. Kevin and Corey on a Wednesday.
Number one for new country. I got some famous friends. Nobody plays more new country. 97.1 Hank FM.
Bowling, 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 keep them balls a-rollin'.
Make your plans now for a fun holiday party at any Royal Pin Entertainment Center. Treat your employees to a great time with bowling, appetizers from chips to heavy hors d'oeuvres, food packages from pizza to prime rib, and a wide range of party options from just bowling to laser tag, limitless VR, go-karts, arcade, and more. You can upgrade with adult beverages, craft beer, premium spirits, and frozen drinks. Want a custom party? Their sales team can make it happen. Reward your team for their hard work. Email events at royalpin.com or visit royalpin.com to book today.
Set them up, knock them down, send them flying, spinning round.
Hurry, space is filling up fast. That's royalpin.com.
Royal Pin, bowling, bowling.
Hi guys, it's Mark. Are you struggling with erectile dysfunction? Did you know that a major medical breakthrough is now available and it isn't a pill? Today, Wednesday, December 14th, we're running a one-day special you won't want to miss out on. Pine Grove Medical Clinic uses the most powerful form of wave therapy. This is a technology clinically shown to repair blood vessels and improve blood flow. It's backed by 60 clinical studies, including from Cambridge. If you're ready to regain the spark in your bedroom, today is your day. Call us now and you'll qualify for the assessment and ultrasound totally free. You'll also get a gift that can produce rapid and powerful results in the bedroom in minutes. You're going to love that one, guys. Trust me. And today only, we're offering 6 tune-up treatments to our patients free. This is an unprecedented offer worth hundreds of dollars, but call today and qualify totally free. Call 317-552-1111. That's 317-552-1111. Guys, put a stop to your erectile dysfunction and get your life back. Call Pine Grove Medical Clinic now to qualify. This offer ends today, Wednesday. 317-552-1111.
To help you find gifts you'll love, Total Wine & More now has 4 stores in Indianapolis. We've stocked the shelves with over 8,000 wines, 4,500 spirits, and 2,500 beers. And our expertly trained elves, guides, and totally low prices are certain to bring joy to your world. This holiday, love what you find, only at Total Wine & More. Now open in Carmel, Noblesville, Nora, and Greenwood. Curbside and delivery available. Drink responsibly. B21.
Need assistance with door and window projects? The Home Depot can help. From inspiration and materials to ordering and installation, our free Millwork virtual apron service can get you moving and doing. Plus, we speak Spanish too. Our associates can help you tackle complex jobs without you leaving the job site, saving you time and money. Call us at 1-833-HD-APRON or visit homedepot.com/MVA. The Home Depot, how doers get more done.
Hubler has all the top brands. Chevy, Buick, GMC, Ford, Acura, Honda, Mazda, Nissan, and more. And every new vehicle includes a 10-year, 200,000-mile warranty. Looking to sell your vehicle? We'll pay you top dollar, even if you don't buy ours. Take it from Brooke Hubler.
You can get a car anywhere, but you can only get a warranty like this at Hubler. 10 years, 200,000 miles.
Visit drivehubler.com.
Hubler has it all.
Warranty available on new vehicles except certain models not transferable or available on leases. A copy of the warranty is available for review at the dealership.
O'Reilly.
Protect your vehicle's engine with Syntec at O'Reilly Auto Parts. Syntec Premium Full Synthetic Motor Oil is formulated for today's engines to dissipate heat and reduce friction and wear. Right now, get 5 quarts of Syntec Full Synthetic and a MicroGuard Select Oil Filter for just $33.99. Try Syntec today, exclusively at O'Reilly Auto Parts.
O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Say big at Payless Liquors. Early Times and Canadian Mist in 100-milliliter bottles are only 99 cents. Jim Beam Whiskey Calendars, $6.99. And Stirrings Cocktail Calendars, $34.99. At all 26 Payless Liquor locations, Miller High Life and the 12-ounce non-returnables are $8.99. Stella Rosa Moscata d'Asti, Coppola Diamond Shard, and Parrot Bay Buckets are all $9.99 each. And for just $39.99, pick up the Maker's Mark 375-milliliter gift set and check out Payless's assorted candy canes. Don't pay more, get more at Payless at Payless Liquors.
Catch another Bud Light Blue Friday broadcast with JMB from 3 to 6 p.m. at the Chaparral Sports Bar and Grill. Enter the football toss, and you could be the next fan to win a pair of tickets to see the Colts take on the Chargers.
The Colts head north to take on the first place Minnesota Vikings. The coverage starts Saturday morning at 10 on 97.1 Hank FM.
It's
Kevin and Querry on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
Just after the show ended yesterday, some white smoke from West Lafayette with the hiring of Ryan Walters, 36-year-old head football coach, the fourth youngest head coach in FBS.
Boy, he looks it too, doesn't he?
He definitely does. Jake, the defensive resume is wildly impressive. I mentioned these numbers earlier. I think they're worth repeating. He was Missouri's defensive coordinator. Brett Bielema takes a job at Illinois and wants to hire him. He comes over to Illinois at the start of the 2020 season. At that point, they were the 97th ranked scoring defense and 114th in yards allowed. They jumped to 29th in scoring and 49th in yards in one season under Walters. The next season, which would be this past year, they climbed to first. They were the best scoring defense in college football this year. Seven teams scored 10 or less against Illinois this season, and they were second in yards. That's what stands out to me the most. You know, again, he seems like a pretty mild-mannered individual. I know a lot of people feel like he's a great connector with people, but what he did defensively at a school that I don't think is gobs and gobs of talent, that's really, really impressive.
And if you look at the places where he's been in his journey, a player at Colorado and then served, I think, as a graduate assistant at Colorado, but he's been at some big-time schools, you know, Arizona, Oklahoma, Missouri, Illinois, so Power Five schools. Probably has worked under a number of different coaches to get kind of an idea. I think that a lot of coaches, Kevin, just naturally bring or take with them little nuggets that they've learned along the way from different guys they've seen and seen, you know, what works, what doesn't, etc. Probably some learning on the job going from a coordinator to a head coach, and it remains to be seen how that will play out. Coaching hires are an interesting thing. You know, sometimes a coach gets hired that you think is a slam dunk. Daryl Hazel looked to be an absolute slam dunk hire, and obviously Purdue knows what happened there. You know, Jeff Brohm was one that also looked like a slam dunk, and it worked out. So certainly hope that this is a situation where once again, and by the way, Daryl Hazel was a super cool dude. I mean, I would have loved to have seen that work out, but it just, for whatever reason, the recruiting tailed off. I thought it was interesting, as we mentioned earlier, that Mockenbee was given a scholarship on day one, because I think everybody was like, wait a minute, that dude wasn't on scholarship?
Yeah, absolute no-brainer. Cool. Yeah. Sounds like Brady Allen, their young quarterback from Gibson Southern, tweeted yesterday he's excited about everything, and obviously that's critical to maintain some of the young talent. You know, we talked about this a little bit earlier, Jake. You could probably go glass half full on the young hire or the retread, however you want to look at it. The retread, you're thinking to yourself, he has experience, might not view this job as a stepping stone, might have a little bit more staying power if you have success at that job, might not be looking to run to the next one. That's a glass half full approach there. The glass half full approach to the young hire could be more open-minded to NIL, more open-minded to the transfer portal, a better understanding, kind of grew up in this new age of college football. So there might be a little bit more kind of like self-energy down that path. Again, the negative would be, if you look at Walter's resume, it's not like he's got these immense ties to the Midwest and Purdue. If he does have success, which would be great for Purdue, does he go elsewhere? Again, you're getting way ahead of yourself in saying that. I would say the question for me resides more, again, offensively. Obviously, Purdue's track record speaks for itself on that side of the ball. And again, it's a little bit low-hanging fruit comparing Purdue to Indiana. But I would argue one of the biggest issues Tom Allen has had at Indiana in his six seasons, Jake, he's had four offensive coordinators.
Yeah.
And Kellen DeBoer left there and had great success at Fresno State and now is one of the young up-and-coming head coaches in college football at Washington. If you can't maintain continuity on that side of the ball, it's very difficult to sustain success. And I think program, again, Purdue's on a different level than Indiana football-wise. But, Jake, when you're these programs that hover around seven-ish wins and you have the occasional miss of a bowl season, it's really important to maintain your entertainment product of being good offensively. Because if you're losing these boring games 17-13, I just think fan bases are going to be quick to check out when you don't have the longevity consistency of a 9-10 win program.
Tom Allen has had rotation of assistant coaches, and he has used the wrong criteria that's important to him to select who to keep and who to allow to walk. And that's the reason why Indiana is where Indiana is.
One thing I do like about Walters and hearing a little bit more about him, extremely aggressive and versatile defensively. If that's kind of a coaching philosophy of his, I would think that would trickle over to what he wants the offense to be. And I think that's really, really important to, again, maintain that aggression and just kind of high-powered air attack that Purdue has created over there. So hoping to have Ryan Walters on this week. Again, he'll be introduced today at noon, and it is a five-year deal for the Colorado product. First defensive hire since Leon Burnett in 1982 for Purdue.
Leon Burnett, man. He was an offensive coach, wasn't he? I thought he was the quarterback's coach, wasn't he? Am I wrong in that? I
thought he had some defensive background. Granted, didn't Tiller have a little bit of defensive background? I mean, he certainly had heavy offense, but...
Leon Burnett's just the one that, you know, that's why Jeff George went there. And then when they got rid of Leon Burnett, they brought in Fred Akers, who was the only coach in college football that did not recruit Jeff George because he ran an option. George is like, yeah, it might be time to transfer, which is where that all went down.
So again, Ryan Walters introduced later today as the Purdue head football coach. Pacers, Warriors tonight. We'll get the latest on that with Chris Denari next.
The Ride with JMV.
Pacers rookie guard Andrew Nembhard with his 31 in their win over Golden State on Monday night. Just the latest example why you should tune in to the Pacers. I'm not suggesting at all this is a playoff team. They're probably going to lose more than they ever win, but fun as absolute hell to watch most of the time. Excitable, fun, with legitimate hope.
The Ride with JMV.
Weekdays 3 to 6
on 93.5 and 107.5. The Fan.
A place for players to play,
and so much more.
Pick up USA Fitness Noblesville, a better way to play.
Pick up USAFitness.com.
Be ready for snow at the Mower Shop and Fishers with a gas or electric Toro snowblower and prepare for mowing season with discounts on select Spartan mowers. 317-849-9500 and themowershop.com.
Hi guys, it's Mark. Are you struggling with erectile dysfunction? Did you know that a major medical breakthrough is now available and it isn't a pill? Today, Wednesday, December 14th, we're running a one-day special you won't want to miss out on. Pine Grove Medical Clinic uses the most powerful form of wave therapy. This is a technology clinically shown to repair blood vessels and improve blood flow. It's backed by 60 clinical studies, including from Cambridge. If you're ready to regain the spark in your bedroom, today is your day. Call us now, and you'll qualify for the assessment and ultrasound totally free. You'll also get a gift that can produce rapid and powerful results in the bedroom in minutes. You're going to love that one, guys. Trust me. And today only, we're offering 6 tune-up treatments to our patients free. This is an unprecedented offer worth hundreds of dollars, but call today and qualify totally free. Call 317-552-1111. That's 317-552-1111. Guys, put a stop to your erectile dysfunction and get your life back. Call Pine Grove Medical Clinic now to qualify. This offer ends today, Wednesday. 317-552-1111.
Life has enough problems. Dragging heavy bags of salt to your water softener shouldn't be one of them. Avoid the salt hassle. Have Elgin Water Care deliver Pro's Pick Solar Salt right to your softener. Elgin Water Care has been servicing all makes of water conditioners and delivering Pro's Pick products here in Indianapolis since 1946. Give Elgin Water Care a call today at 317-251-9223. Get rid of your salt hassle with Elgin Water Care and Pro's Pick Salt.
Christmas cheer is in short supply for our neighbors who are hungry, homeless, hurting. Today you can give them meals, shelter, and care with a gift to Wheeler Mission. You'll also provide addiction recovery, life skills, job training, and other vital care that transforms lives. Your gift is needed right now as hundreds of hurting people are turning to Wheeler Mission for help every day. Share Christmas cheer. Donate now at WheelerMission.org. That's WheelerMission.org.
93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
WIBC HD2, W298BB, WIBC HD3, W228CX, Indianapolis.
The Pacers homestand concludes with the Golden State Warriors this evening at 6:30 on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
It's the 9 o'clock hour in Indianapolis. for that matter, technically speaking, it's the 9 o'clock hour everywhere in the Eastern time zone. It's Kevin and Query here on 93.5, 107.5 The Fan. Joining us now on the Payless Liquors Hotline, he is the television voice of the Indiana Pacers. They will be taking on the Golden State Warriors tonight out at the Fieldhouse. And Chris Denary, the first question that I would have for you, do you believe that tonight you will be calling the name of Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, or Draymond Green in terms of on the court, whether or not they'll be playing?
Well, it'll be interesting. You're right. It's second night of a back-to-back. They lost in Milwaukee last night. Klay Thompson has not played in back-to-backs this year, so he would be the one guy that I would think they might hold out. Now, you know, the game got away from them pretty early, so it'll be interesting to see. I would probably think, I mean, just based on looking at the track record of the year, there's going to be somebody that doesn't play, but I'm not sure that they sit all three. It'll just, you know, we'll know more. There's no shoot around for Golden State. We'll know something maybe later this afternoon, but there were some indications last night that they would play, so we'll just have to wait and see.
Yeah, it almost seemed like the blowout last night for fans that want to watch Steph Curry, that was probably a good thing for tonight. Chris, I'd almost rank them in the order of most likely to least likely: Draymond, Steph, Klay Thompson.
Yeah, I think so. I think Klay coming back, from the injury, even though he played last year, he played 32 games and they won a title. He had two major injuries in back-to-back years, so they've really tried to manage that. So I would agree with you. I think just based on what I've watched this year and how they've done that, I would think the least likely to play would be Klay Thompson in the second out of a back-to-back. They're on a long road trip that started last night. They're in Philadelphia Friday, Toronto Sunday, and then they have a back-to-back next week in New York against the Knicks and Brooklyn. So like the Pacers faced over a week ago with that seven-game road trip, this is a six-gamer for Golden State right now.
And again, we're going to move on, but I know this is honestly, it's a big night for a lot of fans around the area curious about if Steph's going to play. You said we usually get official word on that late this afternoon because there's no morning shoot around. I'm trying to get people a better idea of like what time we might get official word on that.
Well, Steve Kerr will meet with the media at 5:30. So it'll be that late. Yeah, I mean, I don't expect to see anything like we saw with Brooklyn on Saturday when I think we pretty much knew around noon that none of those guys were going to play. And then, they end up winning the game. So I've looked at it throughout the year this year. I think the league has as much parity. I think it has as much balance as we've seen, even though you've seen teams like Boston and Milwaukee, have really good records in the East. There's a lot of young talent. A lot of these younger teams can contend every night. So we'll just have to wait and see.
Chris Denary is our guest. He's the television voice of the Indiana Pacers. Let's talk about the team of which that you have been calling their games, Chris, in the Pacers. Kind of been ebb and flows, right? I think we expected this. Are we starting to see now a little bit more of a realistic representation of the youth than what we saw in the beginning of the year? And by that I mean, you just kind of don't know from one night to the next, where it's going to come from. Does that make sense?
Yeah, you've had some guys that are definitely up and down. I mean, I think, Tyrese Halliburton has been super consistent all year long. And then, Saturday night he goes for 35 and goes 12 of 15 from the field and 7 of 8 from 3. And then a game on Monday that I don't think anybody saw where he didn't have a field goal and scored 1 point on a technical free throw. So he's been very, very consistent. There have been a lot of the other young guys that will go, three or four games really well with double figures and a good rebound effort, and then maybe go three where they don't play so well. I thought the game on Monday night was one of those typical Heat-Pacers games. It really doesn't matter who's in the uniforms. They tend to play like that. And I thought down the stretch it was the Miami veterans, to your point, Jake, that sort of took over. Kyle Lowry hit a big shot, and then Jimmy Butler went on a 7-0 run to sort of put the game away for Miami. And I just thought that their veterans who had been there, done that, played in Eastern Conference Finals, played in big situations, they were the ones that made the plays, and the younger Pacers weren't able to do that.
Again, Chris Denary is with us, the TV voice from Bally Sports. Going back to Monday night, obviously with how Miami guarded Tyrese Halliburton, you know, the ability to switch Bam Adebayo on him is such a luxury that Miami has. How have you seen Halliburton, you know, been maybe guarded here in recent games? It seems like a ton of length that teams are putting on him, kind of realizing that he is the head of the snake, and if we're able to neutralize him at all, that can really put a stranglehold on Indiana's offense.
Yeah, there's no question. I go back to the Minnesota game a week ago, and they had Jaden McDaniels, who's 6'10", you know, guarding Tyrese. Now, remember, Tyrese, you know, has got good size. He's 6'5 or 6'6 as a point guard. So teams have tended to put a bigger player on them, and it all is can be predicated with what their roster looks like and, you know, how they're going to defend other players on the floor. Miles Turner, you know, are you going to put Bam Adebayo out there? And they do, Miami does, because they do a lot of switching. They'll switch one through five, and Adebayo is that rare player at the five position that can really guard one through five. So you have seen a lot of teams, you know, put a lot of size on Halliburton, and to the most part, it's not been as effective maybe as they would hope, because Tyrese is averaging 20 points and almost 11 assists per game. But give Miami a lot of credit, and it was an off night for Tyrese. I mean, he could not get his three-point shot going and struggled getting the ball to the basket. But that's a very rare occasion. I mean, I think I can count on one hand, you know, the games that he has not played well this year, and the Pacers have played 28 of them. So, you know, I think for the better part of 25 games, he's been really, really outstanding.
Chris, you know that one of my favorite guys in terms of his potential is Isaiah Jackson, but I feel like he's been given plenty of opportunity. He hasn't played poorly. I'm not saying that. But I kind of expected to see a little bit more out of him in terms of development or next step so far this season than what I've seen, which has been fine, but just not necessarily a huge step just yet. Am I being too harsh?
Well, I think, you know, when you're 20 years old and you're in your second year, I mean, you're going to take some steps forward and some steps backwards. He did not play on Monday, and part of that was, you know, Miami starts two smaller forwards in Jimmy Butler and Martin. So it was real hard, you know, for Jalen Smith not to start. And then with Jalen Smith coming off the bench, he got the majority of the backup post minutes behind Miles Turner. But if you go back over a week ago in the win at San Francisco against Golden State, Jackson was outstanding. He had 13 points. He had 6 of 10 from the field. He and Nembhard really played well. They had that alley-oop working well. So it's just it's one of those situations I think we all knew at the start of the year, as you develop these young players, the core of your franchise moving forward, you are going to have some highs and you're going to have some lows. And that's to be expected. He's a guy that I think, you know, will continue to get minutes, you know, based on matchups, but he's going to continue to get minutes, and I expect a guy like him to bounce back.
Chris Denary's with us, TV voice on Bally of the Indiana Pacers. Again, tonight it's a 7 o'clock tip between the Pacers and the Warriors. I thought Rick Carlisle had an interesting comment yesterday, Chris, about Andrew Nembhard. I thought it was a great question of, you know, the last time you've trusted a rookie this much on the defensive end of the floor. And he brought up a name that, you know, obviously it isn't really thought of in high regard here in Indiana. But he brought up Tayshaun Prince. And you look at the assignments that Andrew Nembhard has drawn over the last couple of weeks. I mean, it was Jimmy Butler on Monday. For long stretches, it was Steph Curry last week, or Damian Lillard, or even LeBron. It's, you know, basically whoever is the other team's best player. Not necessarily like body type, size, speed. They just trust Nembhard that much. And I think that's such an important piece the Pacers have lacked, of a guy that they really trust to be kind of the lead defender in recent years. If Nembhard can become that for the Pacers, I think that is vital for a team that has definitely struggled over the years on that end of the floor.
Yeah, there's no question. And I think one of the other guys, too, is Nesmith. I think Aaron Nesmith is a good defender. He's athletic. And it gives the Pacers some wing assets out there to defend on the ball. And, you know, you'll hear coaches talk about, as much as it's team defense, it really starts with you guarding your yard or guarding your man. And a lot of times that's unfortunately where the Pacers have breakdowns, is not taking care of your assignment out on the perimeter. And that puts a lot of pressure at the rim on Miles Turner, Isaiah Jackson, Jalen Smith. So, yes, to have guys like Nembhard, who has accepted that role, he's sneaky defensively. You know, he's good for at least a charge, maybe two charges per game. He seems to always be in the right position, whether he's guarding off the ball or on the ball. So, absolutely, I think a lot of people knew he was a good player coming out of Gonzaga. I'm not sure anybody thought that he would make the contributions this early, but he's been really, really good for the Pacers here through the first third of the season.
Could Aaron Nesmith develop into, Chris, an elite enough defensive player that he becomes a permanent rotation guy in the future, despite if he does not take big steps offensively?
Yeah, I mean, if you look at him, I just made this note, in his last three games, he's 7 of 11 from 3, and he has shot the ball with great confidence over the last week, and his three-point shooting's up to 37% on the year. He's averaging about 8 points per game. So, you know, I don't know if he's a guy that is a, you know, 12 to 15-point scorer, but to your point, Jake, if you can be a solid defender, if you can, you know, contribute off the bench or even in a starting role and contribute somewhere around 10 points per game, but you are a lockdown defender, then there's absolutely a role for you in the rotation with this Pacers team.
Okay, Chris Denari with us here. It'll be him, Quinn, and JJ. Coverage begins at 6:30, tip at 7 o'clock tonight for the Pacers. Can you fill us in a little bit on the latest with Chris Duarte? It looks like a G League assignment for him.
Yeah, I think that was the good news the other day that Rick talked about on Monday. He practiced with the Fort Wayne Mad Ants, and that's really one of the advantages with the Mad Ants housed in the Pacers practice facility, and then, you know, playing some games in Indianapolis and then, you know, some games in Fort Wayne. But he will play two games this week against Wisconsin, tonight and Friday, and they'll assess that, but it's to get him some game action. Guys, Friday, or make it Sunday, against the Knicks will end a stretch of 19 games in 33 days. The Pacers will have not had multiple days off between games for over a month, and multiple times they've played back-to-back games. And what does that tell you? They haven't had a lot of practice time. And so those are the things that Chris Duarte needs, is legitimate practice time where guys are really going up and down. But as Rick Carlisle said on Monday, we can't stimulate game conditions either. So that's why tonight and Friday are very important for Duarte to get back into a game situation. And then maybe he would be available on Sunday afternoon when the Knicks are at Gainbridge Fieldhouse.
Chris, there are four teams left in men's college basketball, if I'm not mistaken, this season that are still undefeated. Do you think Quinn Buckner could name all four?
That's a great question. I remember a few years ago when Andrew Nembhard and Gonzaga were getting very, very close and playing in the national championship game at Lucas Oil Stadium. That was only one. But he's got that team up in West Lafayette that's unbeaten. He probably knows. There's no question. He probably knows.
And for those that are curious why I'd ask, Quinn Buckner, of course, on the 76 Indiana team that was the last unbeaten in college basketball history at 32-0. Purdue, UNLV, Mississippi State, and New Mexico are the four. I believe that's the last four.
Virginia, right?
Virginia lost, didn't they? Is Virginia unbeaten?
I thought they're still undefeated. If it gets ugly tonight, one way or the other, Chris, you got to put his feet to the fire and test him on that one.
Virginia, you're right. Virginia's 8-0, yeah. Sorry. Yeah, you got to test him, Chris. But Purdue, listen, Purdue, who's going to be in your building on Saturday playing, they're not going to go undefeated, but they're pretty darn good.
Oh, they're good. I mean, you look at the two freshman guards. I mean, and I'm very proud. I mean, as a Westfield High School alum, I said this a few years ago. I'll say this. You know, having been the marketing director at Butler starting in 1989, and to sit in Lucas Oil Stadium and watch Butler play for the national championship game sort of blew my mind, right? I would say last year, having, you know, gone to high school in Westfield, to know that there's a Mr. Basketball from Westfield High School, sort of a mind blower. But Braden Smith's been outstanding. I mean, Matt Painter and his staff, they do such a great job up in West Lafayette. It's been fun to watch them. I mean, think about what they accomplished last year. They had a top five pick in the NBA draft in Jaden Ivey, and they have not missed a beat this year.
Yeah, extremely impressive to get back to number one. All right, Chris, I know a lot of people will be watching tonight, certainly plugged in a little bit later to get the latest on Golden State's availability for this one. Pacers-Warriors tonight at 7 before they're off to Cleveland. The Pacers take on the Cavs at 7:30 on Friday. Always appreciate it, Chris.
All right, thanks, guys. Have a great morning.
That's Chris Denari, my former basketball coach back in the day. Great coach. Great temperament on the sidelines. Always enjoyed playing for Chris.
Was Chris one of those that was screaming at you as fourth graders? Come on!
You know, unless the Connecticut water wasn't filled up to the brim on the sidelines, everything was good with him.
Yeah, so Virginia's the fifth. So Virginia at 8-0, Mississippi State, UNLV. UNLV is coached by, I think, Lon Kruger's son, right? Isn't that right?
Really?
I think that's right. But they've kind of had a resurgence. Vegas was, man, when Tark was there, Vegas was just different level, man. And you know, I've mentioned before, as an Indiana fan, UConn is the other one. Man, how am I missing
something? Oh, yeah, we might have Thad Mata on, by the way, Thursday or Friday. Butler opens up Big East play with UConn
so
on
Butler
Saturday.
can give UConn their first loss. ESPN.com has the teams listed based on their conference record. So, like, some of them, like UConn's, has not yet played in the Big East, so they're not leading in their conference. And it's like, wait a minute, they're 11-0, but they're not listed as the top of the Big East. UNLV, though, when Jerry Tarkanian was coaching UNLV, I had like this Bob Knight brainwashed moral opposition to UNLV because I'm like, those guys are just there to play basketball. They're not going to class. University of no learning value. And as I've gotten older, and of course, one of the things that stunned me was to learn that Knight and Tarkanian were actually very good friends. And then, you know, I realized that what Tarkanian was doing was taking some players, not all, obviously, but taking some players that may not have otherwise had an opportunity to get an education and to go to school and to find structure and to get on the right path in life. And basketball was the vehicle to be able to do them. And I'm like, you know what? That's cool, man. There's a place for that for certain. And he had some unbelievable teams. The 87 team, I think, might have even been, well, I don't know about that. That 90-91 run they had was amazing. And the 91 Final Four UNLV team practiced at North Central, which is one of the coolest things of my high school years because we were walking out of school and Tarkanian let us come in and watch them practice. And that was pretty awesome because they were undefeated. They were number one, and then they were upset by Duke. But it was pretty cool, man.
If you look at Purdue's schedule, and I'm just saying this when they got back from Portland, I don't necessarily see like an obvious hiccup. Again, Davidson Saturday night, it's not the Davidson I think we're used to. They don't have a great, great resume this year, 7-3 on the season. Home games with New Orleans and Florida A&M, and then they'll start Big Ten play with Rutgers at home. They are at Ohio State on January 5th. After that, they've got Penn State and Nebraska at home. So, I mean, at Ohio State on January 5th is probably the one that you point to. But if they can just hold serve on their home floor and inside a Gainbridge Fieldhouse on Saturday, I mean, they could get to mid-January and still be undefeated. By no means do I think, like, Purdue is going to run the table, but basically their Big Ten schedule is very backloaded.
Yeah, I mean,
again, it's wildly impressive that
one would think that they will stay number one longer than a week this time, right?
Yeah, it didn't happen on the same day last year. They lost to Ron Harper and Rutgers.
Yeah. Remember that was the – and it turns out it was like a guy that I think is kind of like a Barstool, almost actor or whatever. Remember the video of the kid running on the floor?
Vaguely.
It was like
Rutgers
a chubby
kid?
A chubby kid, and he had on, like, Oakley Blade rainbowed sunglasses and ran on the field and was like, oh, my God, going crazy. And then you find out it actually was not, like, the diehard Rutgers fan. It was, like, a guy for...
Oh, yeah, they do, like, the Storm Chasers, where basically they just find games of...
Correct.
court storms.
Correct, but it was still kind of fun.
You see the number for T.Y. Hilton in Dallas?
What jersey number?
Michael Gallup wears 13, so he cannot wear
Mike Vanderjagt wore 13 in Dallas, didn't he?
Typical 13.
Mike Vanderjagt, by the way, when he got when he signed with Dallas, had a pool and put a had a star, the Cowboys star, put in the bottom of it, and then got hurt and was released.
I was going to say, I don't feel like that lasted too long.
Yeah, it did not. I'll go with, for T.Y. Hilton, that he is going to wear jersey number 10.
I feel like this doesn't have a lot of great wide receiver history with this 15. Number.
16.
Okay.
I think of 16, I think of, like, that's the backup quarterback.
Trevor Lawrence or Peyton Manning's jersey number.
Trevor
high
Lawrence,
school, right?
AFC Offensive Player of the Week. Do you think the Jags can challenge Tennessee?
I mean, the Jags, I agree with what Steven said. They do have good young talent.
Two-game lead right now for Tennessee.
The Jags
four
and
to
Lions
go.
Will both be like sexy picks next year at the beginning of the season. This is the year they really take a big step forward.
They do play each other again this season, Tennessee and Jacksonville, so that could get a game closer. Obviously, Jacksonville just won last week, but they both still play Dallas. So Tennessee would still have to slip up a couple of times for that to be a race down the stretch. All right, we're going to get is it Scott Ritchie. Is that right, Mark?
Correct.
Scott Ritchie is going to join us to close out the show. Covers the Fighting Illini for the News Gazette. So we'll get a little bit more on the Ryan Walters front with him. Pop quiz coming up in a few minutes. Again, Ball State, Georgia Southern tickets. That is a week from tonight at Worthen Arena. A pair of tickets we're giving away to see Michael Lewis and his bunch.
And also, a reminder, Kevin, Ball State going to be at the Fieldhouse 3:30 on Saturday against Illinois State.
Correct.
Part of that Indy Classic doubleheader.
And again, we're hoping to have Thad Mata on either tomorrow or Friday to talk about Butler's big game with UConn at Hinkle coming up this Saturday. For now, though, Morning Checkdown.
The Morning Checkdown, brought to you by Ball State Basketball. Get your tickets at ballstatesports.com on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
The Bucks beat the Warriors by 17 last night in Milwaukee. You say to yourself, Jake, that's great. There's a radio station in Indianapolis. Why do I care about the Bucks and Warriors? Well, I'll tell you why. Because the Warriors now come to Indianapolis, but Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, Draymond Green did not play in the fourth quarter last night. We shall see what that means in terms of their availability tonight for the Warriors and the Bucks. 7 o'clock tip at Gainbridge Fieldhouse.
Pacers slight underdog there. We'll see if Vegas, if that's an indicator they believe that some of those big three will sit out. I don't know if anyone cares about the Colts injury report anymore, but might as well throw it in there. The Colts bump everything up a day this week with a Saturday afternoon game against a 1 o'clock kick, NFL Network, Fox 59, Noah Eagle, and Nate Burleson on the call for that one. Kenny Moore still did not practice yesterday. Again, he's been dealing with an ankle issue for a couple weeks now. So Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, the practice schedule for the Colts this week. A matchup to watch, certainly on Saturday, Justin Jefferson, Stephon Gilmore. We'll see how much Gilmore follows Justin Jefferson around.
Pretty darn good, man.
Jake Jefferson is 465 yards away from breaking Calvin Johnson's single-season record. Four games to go. Of course, you do play an extra game, but he is one of the best players in the league, bar
none. He's
this one for Mr. Gilmore.
Hopefully we're saying that a couple times.
Can we play that one more time just because it's so good?
This one for Mr. Gilmore.
How about a shout-out to Alec Pierce, Mark, for a nice game Sunday night against
Alec
the
Pierce
Cowboys.
You want Alec Pierce?
Yeah, sure.
Sure, okay.
Thought he bounced back.
Poor Alec Pierce.
Yeah, poor in October, or maybe it was November for Pierce, but
he knows his name by now, right?
Had a nice outing.
I don't know.
Against the Cowboys. How about this note on Jefferson? Jefferson's got 1,500 receiving yards in the year. He's accounted for 43% of the Vikings' total receiving yards. It's the highest percentage the NFL has seen in a decade.
You know, that's actually probably as good a performance statistically for a Jefferson in football since Charles had 17 tackles and 4 sacks when Ridgemont defeated Lincoln 33-0 back in 82.
You know, the Vikings may have Justin Jefferson. You know what the Colts have?
We have Matt Ryan.
Boom.
You really showed them.
Boom.
No wonder the spread's only 4. Is the spread still at 4?
Is it? I don't know. Did it drop? I thought it was 4.5 to open.
4.5 to open. Last I saw was 4.
Mark, I'm digging your Pabst Blue Ribbon t-shirt.
Thank you.
I thought it was a Bears t-shirt when I walked
got
in.
It for me.
Santa.
Yes,
Milwaukee
right.
Santa brought that back.
Milwaukee Santa.
Speaking of Santa, pop quiz coming up next. Pair of tickets, Ball State, Georgia Southern, week from tonight at Worthen Arena. Give us a call, 317-239-1070.
It's the Colts VIP tailgate presented by Hayes & Sons Restoration. Make your game day experience the best it can be. Log on and get your tickets now. It's BullseyeEventGroup.com.
With Discover, you can redeem your rewards for cash in any amount at any time. Learn more at discover.com/redeem rewards. Terms apply.
Hi, Sarah. I'm sorry I'm late. The traffic is crazy.
Yeah, it is. And it doesn't help that gas prices have skyrocketed. I can't believe how much it costs for gas now.
Everyone's talking about how much gas is, but I never pay full price for gas anymore. I just use the free Upside app, and I get cash back for every gallon of gas I buy.
Wait a minute. Are you saying you actually get paid real cash when you buy gas with the Upside app?
Yeah, real cash every time I buy gas.
What? That sounds like it could really add up.
I've made around $200 already.
Wow, that's serious extra money. I'm downloading the free Upside app now.
Download the free Upside app to earn real cash back every time you buy gas. Use promo code CAR5 for an extra 25 cents per gallon cash back in your first fill up. You can cash out anytime right to your bank account, to PayPal, or an e-gift card. Just download the free Upside app and use promo code CAR5 for a 25 cents per gallon bonus in your first tank. That's code CAR5 for 25 cents per gallon cash back in your first fill up. Cashback's not available in gas in New Jersey and Wisconsin.
Making Moves is brought to you by LinkedIn Jobs.
After redshirting his first year at Ohio State, Joe Burrow spent the next 2 years as JT Barrett's backup. With Dwayne Haskins on the roster, Burrow didn't see much playing time and decided to transfer. LSU head coach Ed Orgeron zeroed in on Burrow and landed him. In his second season at LSU, Burrow led the Tigers to a 15-0 record, a national championship, and arguably the best season ever by a college quarterback.
Build your winning team today. Go to LinkedIn.com/sports.
You know that feeling when your football team adds that one player with every skill they've been looking for? It's time your business knew how it felt too. LinkedIn Jobs taps into a network of over 850 million professionals to find the right people for your role. LinkedIn Jobs helps you narrow down to the most qualified candidates so you can start hiring the right people. Go to linkedin.com/sports to post your job for free. That's linkedin.com/sports. Terms and conditions apply.
At the Home Depot, we have plenty of Christmas trees to make your holidays even more magical. Hundreds of full, easy-to-assemble artificial trees that look so real, you may be convinced they actually are. And for those who love that fresh pine smell, we have a parking lot full of fresh-cut trees to call your own. We'll even help you load your tree in the car so you can bring home the holidays. The Home Depot, how doers get more done.
Dell Technologies' Days of Deals for Business start now with fresh, limited quantity deals on tech to drive productivity. Save on select performance laptops and desktops powered by 12th Gen Intel Core processors. Don't forget special pricing on the latest monitors, docks, and accessories, plus free shipping on everything and special financing with Dell Business Credit. Call a Dell Technologies advisor at 877-ASK-DELL. That's 877-ASK-DELL. 877-ASK-DELL.
Well, this is different. It's Saturday. On Saturday, the Colts play the Vikings in Minnesota Saturday. Matt Taylor has the kickoff at 1 o'clock on your home for the Colts. 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
If he's number one for new country.
I got some famous friends. Long neck eyes, long beard, never broke my...
Nobody plays more new country.
Until you can.
97.1 Hank FM.
Have you studied? Can you handle the pressure? Sharpen your pencils. It's time for the Pop Quiz with Kevin and Query. Brought to you by Jiffy Lube, Indiana's favorite oil change since 1985.
All right, time for the Pop Quiz. 317-239-1070. A pair of tickets to go see the Ball State Cardinals versus Georgia Southern, the Fighting Conrad Brunners, coming up a week from tonight at Worthen Arena. Again, Michael Lewis got some nice Indiana flavor with high school products from the state on that roster. This has got some variety to the pop quiz here, Scotty. A lot of variety here to the pop quiz. Jake, number 1 through 8.
You know, my favorite number, Jay Edwards, number three.
Numero Trace, how many goals Argentina scored yesterday as they move on to the World Cup final is who, Mark?
Joel.
Joel.
Joel. Last I heard, the score was 3-1. So.
Joel, is your radio down?
Is your radio down?
No.
Can you hear me? Sorry.
We got you now.
First time doing this, Joel?
Joel, wasn't the final score? I thought it was Trace nil.
Oh.
Did Croatia score? Did I miss a goal?
3-0 here.
Is Joel in Croatia?
He might be in Qatar. Joel, how are you doing on this Wednesday morning?
Doing all right.
Are you a fan of soccer? Do you have rooting interest here in France-Morocco later today?
Not a terrible amount, no. Joy when a World Cup happens, but outside of that, I'm usually not watching it.
Joel, do you normally wake up around 10?
I do. No. I've got two two-year-olds. I mean, I've got kids jumping on my bed at 5:30 in the morning.
All right, fair enough. Now, you and Mark and Coach McKillop all seem to have that in common. Joel, have you called the program before?
No, it's the first time.
Well, we appreciate it. Can we play Get to Know Your Listener real quick?
What's that?
Can we play Get to Know Your Listener real quick?
Sure.
How old a fellow are you, Joel?
I'm 42.
42-year-old Joel, okay. And that would mean that you graduated from high school somewhere, quick math tells me, like around, what, 98, somewhere in there?
99,
okay. And that was from what school?
West Richland High School in Noble, Illinois,
okay.
Joel, you said you have two-year-olds. Was that plural? You got twins?
We adopted and then found out we were expecting.
That's cool.
That happens. Awesome.
That seems to happen a lot, by the way. That's cool.
We got two boys 7 months apart.
Now, is it true that any job in your hometown is listed as a noble profession?
No. We're circling the toilet, man.
In my opinion, that sucked.
So I assume the boys will be in the same grade?
We'll see what happens. But there's a good possibility. I think one's born at the end of December and another one's born in the middle of July. So it just kind of depends on how the school looked at that.
Gotcha. Well, that's awesome. You guys did that. That's really, really cool. Kudos to you guys.
That is. Yeah. All right, Joel, you ready for question number one?
Sure.
Pacers and Warriors tonight at the Fieldhouse. Which of the two has the better record this season?
Warriors.
It's kind of a trick question.
Pacers are 14-14. I feel like the Warriors are kind of hovering around 500, too.
Yeah.
Trick question.
I would have thought it would have been the Warriors, but I haven't really been paying too much attention.
Okay. Warriors, Pacers, or they both have the same record?
Same record, yeah.
Okay. All right. Today marks the 7th. I mean, guys, you have two-year-olds jumping on him 3 hours ago. Know. Give him benefit of the doubt.
Takes him a while to get his engines revving.
Today marks the 75th anniversary of the founding of which sports organization? Boy, this is a nice layup here for number two, Scotty. NASCAR, NBA, LPGA, or the Pro Bowlers Association? I assume that's actual bowling and not like the game they used to play in Hawaii.
I'm going to go with the NBA.
I mean, how are we supposed to know that, Scotty?
Well, like I said, it takes Joel a while to get his engines revving, right? Right? All right, question number three. Argentina advanced to the World Cup final for the sixth time thanks to their win over Croatia yesterday.
That wasn't bad by you.
Thank you. Which country has played in the most World Cup finals? Is it Argentina, Brazil, Italy, or Germany?
I'm going to go with the lead-in thing.
I would not have gotten this, by the way.
You know what?
I feel like I would have said Brazil.
Pink Floyd was huge in this country, especially when their album The Wall came out.
Let's see. You said Brazil, Italy, and
Germany.
Argentina and Germany. So let's go with Germany.
Okay.
All right, number four, Joel. On this day, 1980, the New Orleans Aints snapped their 14-game losing streak, allowing their fans to take the grocery bags off their heads. Who did the Saints defeat to get their only win of the 1980 season and halt their long skid? The Baltimore Colts, the New York Jets, the Atlanta Falcons, or the St. Louis Cardinals?
I didn't even know I was born. Well, that's
go with the Colts.
You were born in 80?
Yeah, I was born in 80.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, last question for you. Alex Ovechkin last night recorded his 29th career hat trick. In the process, he scored his 800th career goal, reaching 20 goals for the 18th consecutive season. 18 straight 20-goal seasons is the third longest streak in NHL history. This is really convoluted. Gordie Howe has the longest streak with 22 seasons. Which guy whose initials are also the same for when somebody tells you a fib is second? Wayne Gretzky, Mario Lemieux, Brendan Shanahan, or Jaromir Jagr?
Brendan Shanahan.
Okay.
Joel, you a Ball State fan?
Yeah.
You excited to go to the game week from tonight?
I hope that my wife gives me the night off.
Well, you deserve it after this effort on this pop quiz here. Pacers host the Warriors tonight. The better record? It was a trick question. Both 14 and 14.
Question number two. It was, and this is why I said it takes him a while to rev his engines in the morning. NASCAR 75 years ago today was the correct answer.
You blow it.
German,
stay on the line, Joel.
The Jets, Brendan Shanahan to round out the pop quiz. To round us out next, we'll talk a little, get a little information about who Purdue just hired as their head coach with a guy that's covered him over the last few years. That conversation next.
Hey, Alexa, you want to go out with me?
Fat chance. Dog breath.
Okay, I was just, you know, just asking.
If you want to do the smart thing, say, Alexa, play 107.5 The Fan.
Now that's smart.
Hi guys, it's Mark. Are you struggling with erectile dysfunction? Did you know that a major medical breakthrough is now available and it isn't a pill? Today, Wednesday, December 14th, we're running a one-day special you won't want to miss out on. Pine Grove Medical Clinic uses the most powerful form of wave therapy. This is a technology clinically shown to repair blood vessels and improve blood flow. It's backed by 60 clinical studies, including from Cambridge. If you're ready to regain the spark in your bedroom, today is your day. Call us now and you'll qualify for the assessment and ultrasound totally free. You'll also get a gift that can produce rapid and powerful results in the bedroom in minutes. You're going to love that one, guys. Trust me. And today only, we're offering 6 tune-up treatments to our patients free. This is an unprecedented offer worth hundreds of dollars, but call today and qualify totally free. Call 317-552-1111. That's 317-552-1111. Guys, put a stop to your erectile dysfunction and get your life back. Call Pine Grove Medical Clinic now to qualify. This offer ends today, Wednesday. 317-552-1111.
Hey there, Jake Query for the Good Feet Store of Indiana. Good Feet Store and their self-care journey is something that I love talking about because I am confident, you know, putting my name out there and saying, look, the inserts from the Good Feet Store, the arch support inserts, I've had such good success with them. I am confident that you will as well. If you've been suffering from foot pain or maybe you just want to be preventative about it and improve your quality of life, because that plantar fasciitis is grueling, debilitating, so to speak. Then you find out about the personalized experience and the premium arch supports of the Good Feet Store, and you think to yourself, where has this been all my life? Well, it's been right there for you, Greenwood and at 82nd and Dean in Clearwater, the two locations where you can go in for a free, no-obligation personalized fitting. And by that, I mean simply standing to get an imprint of your foot, finding out where the pressure points are, and getting inserts that are made to the contour of your foot, not those one-size-fits-all jobs. Lifetime warranty, American-made product, and a pain-free future for you. It's what I love about the Good Feet Store. I've had great results. I'm confident you will as well. Check them out at goodfeetindy.com.
Get in zone, AutoZone.
Welcome to AutoZone. Thinking about gas mileage? If your check engine light is on, it may be affecting your MPGs, but the free AutoZone Fix Finder service can help. With the most complete free warning light report backed by technician-verified fixes, you'll know what's affecting your gas mileage and more, and you don't have to drive too far to find the fix. The free AutoZone Fix Finder service is available at all 6,200 stores.
Get in zone, AutoZone.
See details at AutoZone.com.
Dell Technologies Days of Deals for Business start now with fresh, limited quantity deals on tech to drive productivity. Save on select performance laptops and desktops powered by 12th Gen Intel Core processors. Don't forget special pricing on the latest monitors, docks, and accessories, plus free shipping on everything and special financing with Dell Business Credit. Call a Dell Technologies advisor at 877-ASK-DELL. That's 877-ASK-DELL. 877-ASK-DELL.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Fansville, where the refs are always wrong and Dr. Pepper is always right.
Always.
Where the mountains are capped with cooler ice and children learn the 23 flavors of Dr. Pepper before they learn the alphabet.
Smart.
It's the one place where a man is a 6 unless he's wearing face paint.
He's a 10.
And where fans deserve a Dr. Pepper no matter if they win or lose.
But we're gonna win.
Get ready for anything to happen this college football season on Fansville by Dr. Pepper.
The one fans deserve.
Grab some today.
Will they find a home? Sponsored by Geico. Jane doesn't mind an apartment with no elevator.
5 flights of stairs is 5 flights of cardio.
Bob is a little less enthusiastic about stairs.
I hate stairs.
Compromise is tough, but these two won't have to compromise when they bundle renters and car insurance with Geico. It's easy, and they could save even more. In the end, Jane and Bob found an apartment that's a 4-story walk-up. And Bob?
Yeah, there's a freight elevator she doesn't know about.
What were you talking about?
Nothing.
Bundling without compromise at geico.com.
Protect your vehicle's engine with Syntec and O'Reilly Auto Parts. Syntec Premium Full Synthetic Motor Oil is formulated for today's engines to dissipate heat and reduce friction and wear. Right now, get 5 quarts of Syntec Full Synthetic and a MicroGuard Select Oil Filter for just $33.99. Try Syntec today, exclusively at O'Reilly Auto Parts.
O'Reilly Auto Parts.
Catch another Bud Light Blue Friday broadcast with JMB from 3 to 6 p.m. at the Chaparral Sports Bar and Grill. Enter the football toss, and you could be the next fan to win a pair of tickets to see the Colts take on the Chargers.
The Chicago Bears take on the Philadelphia Eagles Sunday at noon on 93.5 and 107.5 The Fan.
You're listening to Kevin and Query on 93.5 and 107.5, The Fan.
Again, Ryan Walters, new Purdue head football coach, will be introduced to the media in about 2 hours up in West Lafayette. It's a 5-year deal for the 36-year-old head coach. Again, the 4th youngest in college football. He leaves an Illinois defense that, frankly, just a remarkable turnaround and what he did there in his 2 seasons. To learn more about Ryan Walters, we'll go to someone that covers Illinois athletics for the News Gazette. It is Scott Ritchie on the Payless Liquors Hotline. Scott, good morning.
Morning.
Ryan Walters, the loss there, what he did with Illinois, the reaction in general, I guess, from Fighting Illini fans.
I mean, just based on everything I saw and heard, it feels like the Illinois fans are handling it pretty well, and I think that's mostly because everyone, and myself included, saw this day coming. Now, did anyone think it might be Purdue? Maybe not, but Ryan Walters is going to be a head coach sooner rather than later. And, certainly earned that opportunity after what he was able to do with what was not a very good defense that he inherited.
Did they get very deep at all with Colorado on that front? My co-host Jake was asking me that earlier. Obviously, Deion Sanders, quite the splash there. But the alma mater of Colorado, did things get very far along with Ryan Walters there at all?
So, I guess end of November, early December, Brett Bielema, gave Ryan Walters some time to go interview for, multiple jobs, as it sounds like. I don't know that, Colorado got very far, down that process, before, obviously, the splash hire with Deion Sanders. But, that was, as soon as they made their in-season change, it was like, okay, well, there's, a potential landing spot, for Ryan Walters to get his first head coaching job. But, to be honest, he probably got the better job of the two at Purdue. The Pac-12 is sort of a mess. At least the outside of the top teams, and two of those are headed to the Big Ten anyway. So I think even if there was some nostalgia factor with Colorado, since he played there, I don't know that he didn't make the better professional move and focus his attention elsewhere.
Scott, it's probably difficult for any of us to know unless we're in practice all the time, in the locker room, but you get a pretty good idea. You cover the Illini, you're around it a lot. When you look at at him in Ryan Walters? You know, is this a guy that's like the in-your-face, jump-up-and-down, high-spirited guy? Is it more of the Tony Dungy, quiet grace kind of leader? What kind of coach can Purdue fans expect?
I think he has, you know, the ability to be a little bit of both. And, you know, when he's, you know, meeting, you know, with us or the media types, like, he's, you know, he's pretty, you know, laid back and, you know, it offers, you know, really good insight into kind of, you know, what he, you know, was trying to do defensively. And then, you know, talking with the players, you know, like, he would get on them, you know, when it was necessary. So I think, you know, he's maybe got that perfect balance. But I think the biggest thing, just from maybe a player standpoint, was like, a lot of his defensive players were Lovie Smith recruits that Illinois was not able to develop very well in the Lovie Smith era. But he took and turned into, I mean, a guy like Kirby Joseph. Lovie Smith had moved him to wide receiver, you know, not long before he, you know, lost the Illinois job. And Illinois, you know, Ryan Walters got deal and moved him back to safety, and he turned into a third-round draft pick. So I just think, you know, he instilled this belief in his players, and like, they felt that from him. And I think that maybe, you know, more than anything, it was a real push behind, you know, how much that defense improved.
Yeah, it's wildly impressive, the defensive jumps they've taken. Again, Scott Ritchie joining us here, covers Illinois Athletics for the News Gazette. You look, I guess, a little bit deeper into the defensive side of the ball and what he did for Brett Bielema over there. It seems like it was in a very aggressive unit and a unit that really kind of dictated week to week, not necessarily like, hey, we run the 4-3 every week and we do what we do better than anybody else. It seemed like a pretty open-minded to some versatility throughout the season. How would you describe kind of Walters' approach to that side of the ball?
Yeah, it's really multiple. And I mean, I know that word gets thrown around more with offenses than defenses, but you know, he was willing to, you know, adjust his defense, you know, personnel-wise. I mean, the idea behind it was all the same, but personnel-wise, was able to adjust to the team that they were playing. You know, if it was a Wisconsin or an Iowa, they got a little bigger up front. They didn't have, you know, run five defensive backs all the time. That was maybe the main look. It was five DBs, but they could shift as necessary, and that was just such a change at Illinois from the Lovie Smith era, where it was, you know, going to run 4-3, cover 2, and didn't matter what the other team was doing. It didn't matter if maybe the players couldn't handle it. Like, Lovie wasn't going to change his defense for anybody. But Ryan Walters was adaptable and, you know, adjusted over, you know, especially year one, to the players that he had a little bit. And, you know, as they got more comfortable, I think he was able to maybe turn it into what he, you know, envisioned, you know, in his mind. And obviously, you know, this year couldn't have been much better.
Scott, before we let you go, I want to sneak in a basketball question. I think the world of Brad Underwood personally. I think he can coach Illinois at 7-3. A lot of expectation for him. I realize they've had some roster rotation, but were you surprised at the way that they were handled by Penn State, who beat them by 15? Or did that maybe tell us more about us underselling Penn State as opposed to thinking that we oversold Illinois?
I mean, I don't think it can't be both, but it's probably it was people maybe not thinking Penn State's as good as they are, and those people including the Illinois players, you know, because, you know, Brett Underwood said after the game and during his post-game press conference that, you know, there's one player, he didn't say who, in locker room, that was like, man, we just lost to Penn State. Like, as like, your super negative connotation. Well, I mean, Penn State does two things really well, and it's post up Jalen Pickett on guards and shoot threes, and Illinois let them do both of those things and just gave them confidence. And it's not a great Penn State team, I don't think, but it's a good enough Penn State team to do that to you if you let them operate how they want. But it was just that classic letdown for Illinois, you know, huge, coming off a huge high, you know, beating Texas at Madison Square Garden, number two team in the country, and then just maybe thinking they could roll over, you know, Penn State at home, and they learned that they couldn't. So it'll be interesting to see how they bounce back. Not, you know, super tough game, you know, this weekend against Alabama A&M, but bragging rights next week against Missouri, and that game is just always a little extra.
Scott, appreciate the insight on Ryan Walters. Know it's a busy time for you covering Illinois in their bowl game and coming up with the basketball program, of course, with Big Ten play now underway. So thank you and happy holidays.
Yep, thanks, guys.
Scott Ritchie right there on the Payless Liquors hotline. I thought it was a good point Jake and made about, you know, Lovie Smith recruits. The player development clearly occurred under Ryan Walters. And, you know, if you were hiring the defensive coordinator at Georgia, Jake, your talent level might look a little different in West right. Lafayette. Like, it's a similar recruiting landscape going from Illinois to Purdue. I think that's important. For what it's worth, if you look at how Illinois has recruited under Ryan Walters, there is kind of a blueprint, or I should say more of a footprint, in the state of Florida. So we'll see if that's an area that Purdue can tap into.
By the way, speaking of coaches, you know, football coaches, we talked yesterday around this time, by the way, on the passing of Mike Leach. I just noticed this. I thought it was cool. I wanted to share it. This is from Andrew Berestein on Twitter, who is a writer. As a matter of fact, I'm not sure. Now he is, it looks like he is in television. KTVB, I think that's in Idaho. But he said, my sophomore year at Washington State, I created a blog to cover Washington State football. It was just me and a guy named Jack Ellis going to practices, taking pictures, trying to sneak in media scrums and do whatever we could to try to get some interviews with coaches or players.
Oh, this was awesome.
One day, Mike Leach pulled me aside. He wanted to know who I was, what my deal was, why I was doing this, etc. He said, if you want to be successful, sports writers are kind of like drug dealers. There's so many of them out there, you got to get them hooked on your stuff. He then proceeded to give us media credentials for the entire season. He took it a step further and promoted our website for absolutely no reason other than to be a nice guy. Was the tagline, no fluff, just facts, the corniest thing ever? Absolutely. But he ran with it and came up with it. I think he might have thought it was funny. And as a result of that, we got some serious traction, even managed to sell some ads and get our careers underway.
That's great.
Awesome, isn't it?
So are we drug dealers too, in a way? Educate and entertain. Just inject it into the veins.
We're peddling cold, bitter coffee. Says years later, that experience translated into my job, though I'm a news guy, and Jack's gig as a photographer with the Seattle Mariners, all because Mike Leach gave us a chance to cover his team, and the university allowed that to grow into more opportunities. Thanks for everything, Coach. You gave me a platform to chase my dreams and a lifetime of memories back in Martin Stadium. That's a cool story, man.
Really cool. How about Greg Rakestraw mentioning yesterday that Mike Leach interviewed for the opening at UIndy?
Yeah, that's. Can you imagine?
The OC at Valdosta State under Hal Mumme, interviewed for the opening at UIndy, did not get it, of course. Then that staff moved on to Kentucky, where Leach was the OC under Hal Mumme. Then he was at Oklahoma, I think, for a year. I think he was at Kentucky for a couple of years, Oklahoma for a year, and then Texas Tech after that. And, of course, that led into Washington State and Mississippi State. It's obviously extremely sad that it took such an event for it to happen. But, Jake, the outcry for Mike Leach stories like that yesterday on social media was one of the few, I think, beauties of social media.
Left his footprint on college football, no doubt, with that offense and the way that they move the ball around. No
and question. Off the field, you know, and that story that you just shared. Hoping to have Thad Mata to close out the week, maybe Ryan Walters as well. We'll keep you posted on Pacers Warriors tonight.